nothing worthwhile, the recognized symbol of excellence in crappy podcasting.
I'm Evan Moody.
I'm Andrew Gruthius.
I'm Monique Verdugo.
And you're listening to Nothing Worthwhile
with Moody and Gru.
And Verdugo.
You know what that reminded me of right there? That reminded me of the old Batman TV show intro where you'd have the whole, you know, they do the whole thing and then you didn't know if Batgirl was in the episode until the very end where that cartoon motorcycle would ride across and Yvonne Craig as Batgirl and you were all excited, especially us, especially us teenage boys.
Yes, us young men, yes. We were very excited. Well, we could have done like
against a birthday wish for Robin Snockers. Robin turning 30 today. Happy birthday from your sister and best friend Simona.
Robin Slavia Majora is 40 today. Robin is from Wilmington.
30th birthday to Robin Spuddle from your husband Captain Dennis and your sons Howard and Fred.
And Robin Quiver Staint, happy 40th from Fred and Howard. And the winner today of the Bentley Bucks going to Robin Quiver Staint. Happy birthday, Robin. Congratulations. You got yourself the Bentley Bucks.
We have Robin's Massive Cans, who's 35, from your laughter yoga instructor and best friend, Howard.
Also in Bowling Green, Robin Smones Vernus. Happy 40th. Big 4-0. Love, Howard Vernus.
Very nice. Robin Quiver Spiegel is a mystery age Nunya Bizwax.
Robin Zariolas of Willowbrook celebrating the birthday today. Greetings coming from your girlfriends in the coven.
And Robin Spitzflaps, happy birthday to you.
Happy 35th birthday to my best friend and co-worker, Robin Scott Double G's. I hope you like the wind chimes I got for your birthday. Love, Howard Stinnydick. Happy birthday.
Robin Sprown Mounts. Of Bel Air is 40.
Want to wish a happy birthday to Robin Love Zanel in North Alamo from Bend, Dover, Sink, and Reynosa.
Robin Stite Slot. Did I say that right? Happy birthday, Robin Stite Slot, turning 40 years young. Hope your birthday lakehouse vacation weather is a perfect 90 degrees. That's love from your husband Lenny and your son Hauser Slot.
I needed to take a second, and I wanted to apologize to anybody that I might have let down last night. This is kind of hard to understand, but sometimes you can try so hard at something. Sometimes you can be so prepared and still fail. With every time you fail, it's painful. It causes sadness. And especially as I saw last night, it causes disappointment. I've often said a man's character is not judged after he celebrates a victory but by what he does when his back is against the wall. So no matter how great the setback, how severe the failure, you never give up. You never give up. You pick yourself up, you brush yourself off, you push forward, you move on, you adapt, you overcome. That is what I believe. So, there are those that were so offended by my actions last night. They might have lost faith in me. I absolutely respect your decision to do so. But I'm not talking to them. I'm talking to those people who still believe. Tonight, I speak to those who still proudly stand in my corner. You have not given up on me, and I will not give up on you. WWE Universe is all I got. This is my everything. So I'm not going to say tonight that I'm gonna work harder, that I'm going to be more dedicated. I'm going to put more time in the gym. That's impossible. What I'm going to say to all of you tonight that are going to listen is what happened to TLC will never happen again. It is time to set the records straight. My road to WrestleMania starts right now. Everybody here, everybody watching, I won't be stopped. I can't be stopped.
Have you ever heard of a guy named Peacemaker?
No.
He is a trained killer. We've got trouble with that maniac.
Go! What are you waiting for?
That thing better not crap back there.
Yeah, how's training an eagle, dude? Not without stealing its soul.
Hey, Dad.
It's been kind of a rough go for me lately, Dad.
You don't say.
Somebody shot me. A building fell on me.
You let somebody shoot you?
It's not like I invited him to come shoot me, Dad.
Pathetic.
I thought you were in prison for life.
I work for the government.
Post office?
You think they'd let me out of prison to deliver mail?
I don't know. It's the first government job I could think of.
I kill people for them, okay?
This task force doesn't officially exist, which leaves us on our own.
We call our targets butterflies. They are a serious threat to the safety of American citizens.
There's something weird going on. You think me and Vigilante are too stupid to notice?
Hey, everyone! Which one's me and which one's Eagly?
Okay, you're half right, but you score 50% on the test at school. What do you get? A D. School wasn't my bag. It's for dorks.
That guy's a clown.
But there's something about him that's sad.
Is he a target in sight?
Peacemaker, take him out.
Even the kids?
Yes! Terminate him immediately! Take the shot!
He told me to kill kids. He didn't say why.
Because right now the world needs a son of a bitch. And you're the only one I got.
I thought you loved peace, no matter how many men, women, and children you needed to kill to get it.
I don't know. Lately, I'm having feelings about things. Dad, maybe I'm a grower, not a shower.
What?
An individual you don't like, and then you learn to like.
You're comparing yourself to a chode.
Not in a bad way.
Your dad is not a good man.
Still family.
My advice? Cut it out with the introspection. The mind is a den of scorpions, better left running from, not towards.
We just got shut it! You haven't been shut it?
No.
Two jerks in costumes and a couple of rejects.
It's like a real team out there.
Yo, what the hell is that?
It's a grenade I tied to a Russian tank shell.
Why not just the grenade?
Grenade blows up like two people.
How many people does this blow up?
I don't know. I invented it this morning.
What?
Eat peace, mother.
Breakdown and review of Peacemaker, John Cena, James Gunn, HBO Max, Nothing Worthwhile, the week that was, all the fun bands and comedy band. With a very special guest with a very special last name, it's Nothing Worthwhile, America's number one bicycle podcast.
Come on, everybody talk about.
Wow. I'm crying. I have tears in my eyes after that.
Excuse me?
I have that was a surprise. I'm emotional. Give peace a chance.
We are America's number one bi-coastal podcast featuring two annoying Jews on the West Coast in the great state of Arizona, in the great state of Phoenix to be exact. Doggy free. My name is Evan Moody. Before we get to my partner.
Wait, we don't get to meet the new member of the family?
I'm about to introduce
Monique
Verdugo.
No, not I know Monique, but
this is what we're going to go through. Go ahead. Right. Yes, sir.
No, I meant Road Dog, your new baby.
Well, we do have a new puppy, Jet Moody. He is now going to be Puppy Shango, and Braxton will be upgraded to Road Dog.
Okay.
They're both with mom at work. But speaking of Verdugo,
who is this lovely young lady here?
Our very special guest. Only our second female co-host on Nothing Worthwhile, Miss Mony Verdugo. Please introduce yourself to our audience and tell a little bit about yourself.
Why, hello, everybody. Yes, my name is Monique Verdugo. Evan likes to call me Mony, but usually I go by Mo.
Here she comes now, saying Mony, Mony.
Every time. Trust me, that song was played my whole life. Okay? Mony, Mony. Gotta love it.
Sure was.
Oh, yeah. Every time I was a bartender, they would just play that song every time I would come in. Like, thanks, guys. Love it.
Hey, if you don't have theme music, you haven't made it. So
exactly. I was Norm, you know, from Cheers. Yeah. But when I would come in, Norm! It was
That's
like,
great.
No! You know, and they played the song. I felt so welcomed. But my name is Monique Verdugo. Go by Mo. I am a native. I'm born and raised here in Arizona. Only lived in one other state besides Arizona, but I came back because I just hated it that much. I have, let's see, what else? I am a nerd, very much a nerd. Grew up loving and you know, kind of getting into everything that was nerdy, I guess you can say. I have two kids. One is 10 years old, just turned 10. Not too long ago, and then I have a four-month-old baby girl. So, that's me.
Gee, 4 months old, welcome. And you have like a two-week-old. I mean, I got to get going here.
No,
I got to start.
She's 4 months.
She's
almost 5 months. Yeah.
No, but Evan, Evan's got, you know, he's got the puppy Shango.
No,
you have a new
Mr.
baby.
Pet.
I got caffeine-free Coke Zero. I
mean, you know what? There's something very beautiful about caffeine-free Coke Zero.
So beautiful.
There is. Well, welcome. It's great. It's great to have. It's great to have you here.
Hey, well,
fantastic.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, let's bring in annoying Jew number two, my partner in crime, my best friend in the great state of Florida, in the even greater city of Carl Springs, Andrew Gruthius. Gru, how the hell are you, my friend?
Well, what? My, oh, my turn. Oh.
Thank you. And the show crashes to an immediate halt.
No,
you.
I'm doing fine. Doing fine. Very busy. Very busy time. Springtime is upon us down here in sunny South Florida. Oh, it's a little cloudy today. You know, look, just going from day to day. Lots of stuff going on. But this, I have to say, difficult couple of weeks. Just like. Trying to be in like several different places at once, so to be able to come home and watch this show that you tasked me with was actually what I looked forward to every day.
Mm-hmm.
So this has been actually a fun 2 weeks.
Yeah, I would say the same thing. Without giving away my final thoughts on it, I definitely enjoyed putting on HBO Max and checking out Peacemaker. Yeah. I would have liked to gotten to it last week, but we got our new puppy Jet, and it was a rough couple of days. I mean, he pooped, and you know, mom was screaming, and bags of garbage, and Lysol wipes.
I could imagine that house. I could. It's like a Saturday Night Live sketch. Like both dogs are crapping, they're barking at each other.
Yeah.
Marie is like, "What do we do?" And Moody's like, "Get him away!" Like just people throwing shit all over the house. Just like I can imagine, just like
there's
it being a
everywhere.
Yeah,
you're kind of right. I am known to be a bit.
Just like I'm trying to do my notes on WrestleMania 94.
Like, so like yeah, we created a little pen area for him, and he took what I like to call a spite shit as soon as he put him in. It was like two logs, and Marie was like, everything had to be thrown out. Rugs.
Oh my God!
Paper towels,
Scotch guard the entire house. You come back from work, the entire thing is like jet white. it's all been repainted.
we got young Jet on a schedule, and everything has worked out really, really well.
So you mean when the dog craps on the floor, you don't just take the dustbuster and get it up with that?
Andy, that one's a little more hands-on.
I haven't had that experience, so I don't know.
So,
but Jet is the cutest thing, though.
Thank you.
So cuddly.
We're looking forward to her bat mitzvah.
Yes. There'll be more stories.
Is it a girl?
With Jet. No, it's a boy.
Oh, so her bar mitzvah.
Bar mitzvah. So. All right, guys, listen, before we get to our usual fun and discuss season one of Peacemaker, we're just going to go back and touch upon our last podcast. It was The Journey of Journey, everyone's favorite 80s Bay Area pop rockers, as Gru and I discussed The Journey of Journey with Steve Perry, their eventual breakup, reunion, and breakup again. It was a good one. Mony, are you familiar with Journey at all? Any thoughts on Journey?
I jam out to Separate Ways at least once a day.
Oh, okay.
That's probably one of my favorite songs. Definitely. So I know Journey, of course.
It's interesting. Journey of Journey?
Yeah, well, it's interesting that Mony said Separate Ways, because I've been doing the public address announcing at our varsity baseball games, and one of the songs that I play when there's like Jeopardy going on is Separate Ways. All the kids were like, that sounds familiar. What is that? I'm like, they have one other song that you would know, and nobody ever gets it. They're like, no way, that's not the same. And I'm like, listen to the voice. There is only one voice that sounds like this, you know. So and they all like it. You mean that group has more than one song? So it's interesting.
Absolutely.
It's interesting you said that. But I sit at home at night, and I have these thoughts as I'm watching things, and I usually like to text people who actually have lives, and I want to talk about them, and nobody ever answers me. Sometimes Evan will be like, yeah, no.
No, I'm not chatting with you.
But yeah. I really said this when we went off the air, I really enjoyed going through that the Steve Perry journey, no pun intended. It was a lot of fun. I learned a lot, just talking about great music and what might have been is always interesting to me. That was a great podcast.
It got a good reaction. It got good numbers. Definitely had some online, some people on Facebook and stuff that were happy to see the podcast. You know, to me, it's always incredible. And Andy, we touched upon it. There's probably so much money on the table, but these guys just can't seem to get it together. Or, you know, whether you want to blame Steve Perry, Neil Shah, there's just a tremendous amount of money on the table. But it goes to show that human beings and their interactions, sometimes it's just not enough to just get them back together, whether it's ego or whatever.
Well,
one
question I didn't ask last time, and in re-listening to the episode, I wish I asked it of you, Evan. If, like, Don't Stop Believin' was not what it is, because they still have money rolling in from that. Every jukebox play, every radio play, every time that song is played in any kind of public forum, they get paid. So their money, they haven't sold many albums in the last 20-something years. Steve Perry's solo album was nothing crazy, but yet they still must be making all this kind of money off their previous hits. It's almost like if it wasn't so successful, they probably would have gotten back together, because they probably would have needed the money. They obviously don't need it, because otherwise they would.
Well, yeah, they're obviously generating income, you know, from, like, I'm going to go off of what you said, Gru, is, you know, Journey songs you kind of hear in a lot of, you know, like in movies and TV shows, especially.
Yes.
Like we just talked about Separate Ways. I mean, my son watching Tron, it literally was playing Tron in the arcade. Also, and, you know, the first Tron with Jeff Bridges, playing in the arcade. It's a rolling kind of cycle of the song playing. Also, another song, Faithfully, is another song I hear in a lot of movies. You know, the beginning, you know, intro. Yeah. I hear it a lot.
Open arms.
Yeah, they're generating, you know, kind of selling their music, being like, yeah, you can use my music, but at this price, they don't have to get back together. I mean, they're making their income off of that. They have great songs, just besides Don't Stop Believing. You know?
If you looked at our the podcast that we talked about, they had the one reunion. I just don't think Steve Perry's heart was ever in it. You could see by the photos with the band.
Right, we talked about that.
Interested. He's looking away. I just think, you know, he's pretty much, I won't say he's closed the door completely, but the last series of interviews, he talked more about doing his own music and really moving forward. But at, I don't know, whatever age, you know, these guys are not really the critical and commercial forces that they once were.
I guess maybe it has to do with, like, at some point they get tired of sharing what belongs to them. You know what I mean? Like, at some point, if Steve Perry writes a song, in his mind, do you think he has this idea, well, this is my song, why am I splitting, you know, all the credit with all these other people? You know, I mean, because it seems to happen to pretty much every band at some point or another. You know, make sense? It's just interesting. But it was a fascinating, I mean, it was the kind of podcast that probably needs a sequel. Because there's a lot more, you know, there's a lot more, but it was so much fun. It was so much fun to talk about.
I mean, what do you want to talk about? Their various haircuts in the 70s.
I'd be interested.
Their ridiculous music videos.
Well, I'd be interested.
Those were great at the time, Evan.
Hey, look, you got to listen. I have to say this one thing, because I go around and I see, you know, I watch TV, I see what people wear today. And it struck me as, I think it was when I was watching the Super Bowl and they were showing, Stafford. They were showing Stafford walk in with this wackadoo suit on. Just looked like the Riddler from the Jim Carrey Riddler from Batman Forever. And I'm like, how can we look at this and then look at the 80s and think that the 80s fashions were ridiculous? Like, this is what people wear now.
No, you know? I'm about to say, the 80s aesthetic is coming back.
Good.
Good. And I've seen it, like, shoulder pads, perms.
Benetton?
You know? Like,
because I'm tired of people making fun of me.
And it's like, oh, okay, you guys used to make fun of this, you know, when I tried it back in high school, but now y'all are doing it now, and it's cool. Not cool.
Yeah, but that...
The only way I'll ever accept the 80s coming back is if I see a Jane Fonda workout tape or Richard Simmons comes back to sweat into the oldies. Let me move on from Journey. One quick question, Andrew Gruthius. We're going to touch upon in the world of pro wrestling. I'm sure next podcast we'll get more into WrestleMania and the buildup. But last week, let me bring in Gru right off the top. Last Wednesday, multiple media reports have the WWE making overtures to WWE legend and Hall of Famer Stone Cold Steve Austin to gauge his interest in a match at WrestleMania. We will be there live in April. Stone Cold Steve Austin hasn't wrestled a match in nearly 20 years, but reportedly that could change soon. Sean Ross Sapp of Fightful.com reports that the WWE has made a formal offer to Steve Austin for Mania in April. Wrestling Observer's Brian Alvarez confirmed the report and stated that Austin was discussed for a possible match against WWE Raw superstar Kevin Owens. Stone Cold wrestled his retirement match against Dwayne The Rock Johnson at WrestleMania 19 in 2003. Since then, Stone Cold has made sporadic appearances in the WWE over the years, but has never participated in a full match. He was inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame in 2009. Gru, thoughts on a possible return for one Stone Cold Steve Austin?
Well,
I would watch that.
Obviously, I don't think they would do it unless he was ready. I don't see how one could be out of the ring completely for 20 years and be ready for WrestleMania. That said, that happens, I look forward to the pop. Meaning, when that glass breaks, you know, I think we'll get a massive, you know, opening moment. Here's the thing though, And actually, don't judge me, but this is coming from Vince Russo, who usually I don't like, I don't agree with what he says, but on this one, I think I agree. If you're going to bring back Stone Cold, a guy of this magnitude, it's got to be at the top of the card. It's got to be the attraction, or at least one of the night's attraction. Putting him in the mid card against the Kevin Owens type, Kevin Owens is not a main eventer right now. Like, I feel like you'd have to make it the, like, part of the attraction, not just, you know, something in the middle of night one. Or it's got to be bigger than that, and there's got to be some kind of lead up or a shock, meaning like a mystery opponent or a mystery partner, something like that to, you know, to make it work a little better. That said, you know, on the other hand, I look at it like a little Stone Cold is better than none. I think it'd be fun to see. But I also question, if it's a one-off, I wouldn't be in favor of it.
Yeah, media reports have it that it would be, if they come to terms, it would be a similar deal like Goldberg 4 or 5 times a year, wrestling perhaps Saudi, which their big nostalgia shows.
I can get behind that.
Here's my thoughts. I thought initially he's 53. He's 57.
Wow.
Beyond the pop of the fans going nuts, at 57, you know, a guy who seems to be pretty protective of his legacy, I just don't know. At 57,
what does he have to gain? What does he have to gain at this point?
I don't know, except they're looking, again, you know, 2 nights at Jerry World in Texas, 100,000 people each night. You know, I hear your point about the card at the top of the card, but they're looking for every big name that they can jam into 2 nights. And I don't really have a problem against Kevin Owens. You could sort of create a stunner versus stunner match. That would be probably the angle. But at 57, do I want to see Stone Cold in the ring, perhaps embarrass himself or, you know, have a lackluster match? I can't say I do. But
and what do you do? Like the only way to win on that one is for Stone Cold to come in and squash Owens in 2 minutes, and that does nothing for anybody except, you know, creates a WrestleMania moment, which I don't subscribe to that theory. I'm not in favor of it.
Andrew.
I would have if they put him like in the Royal Rumble or something and built it up a little bit.
He'll be involved with WrestleMania. He may host or he's going to be there in Texas. You know, he'll be involved with the show no matter what. I'm just at 57. I just don't know.
Give him a special referee spot or something like
Mony,
that.
Mony, you mentioned you'd be interested. I know you're not quite the fan that Gru and I are, but as a younger person, Stone Cold, you know anything about him? Would you,
of course.
As a casual fan,
I mean, I wasn't religiously, you know, in the I wasn't, but my dad used to watch it all the time, so I would sit there and watch it with him, and I know Stone Cold Steve Austin. That's one wrestler that I actually admired because he was awesome. I loved his entrances every single time. I used to get excited seeing him, you know, wrestle and everything. And you know, I grew up with that. So I knew at Triple X. I mean, I knew at Triple H. I'm sorry.
I'm good with Triple X.
You know Triple X.
Yeah, Triple X. I'm thinking of the movie. Sorry, but Triple H. You know, I remember him too. You know, and then of course The Rock. I mean, hello. I mean, going off of that, you know, I loved his little intro for the Super Bowl because I was hoping, you guys, I was hoping he was going to do his signature line. I was waiting for it because he was doing The Rock voice.
Yes.
And I was like, oh my God, is he going to do it? Because if he does it, I'm going to scream because that is my childhood right there. You know, is that. But yeah, no, I know Stone Cold Steve Austin. If I hear he's gonna do like some type of thing like this,
they'll get viewers. Yeah.
Absolutely,
Mony. As a casual fan, if you heard that The Rock was gonna be in the main event of next year's WrestleMania, would you be interested? Would you actually watch it? Hello.
Maybe
she's thinking.
Okay. Maybe. I know that sounds bad, but like I wouldn't get as excited for The Rock as I would for Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Interesting.
That is interesting.
Because I see The Rock everywhere. We see The Rock everywhere. So it's true. Not like he's gone like, you know, kind of MIA, not MIA, but you know, like kind of hidden. That's you know what I mean?
But so, the reason that surprises me a little bit is because when you're talking about The Rock, you're talking about whether we love him or not, and we do, but
right.
Regardless of how we feel about him, he's the biggest star in the world right now. And yes, if he is going to headline a wrestling match, his roots, at the biggest wrestling show of the year, I think that would multiply viewership
definitely.
By oh, yeah. millions.
And you're right, Groove.
That's what I think.
Yeah, he is definitely one of the most known super. I mean, yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of views would come in, but me personally,
right. I think Evan and I feel the same way. I think we'd be more, yeah. you know, because we've seen The Rock come and go, but what we haven't right. seen, like Stone Cold. When he was gone, he sort of stayed gone as far as right. wrestling is concerned. But he's been doing, you know, does the podcast and does this stuff. So he's still kind right. of around.
But he's not like he's not, The Rock. Like,
right.
You know.
Yeah. So that's why I think like, I think I agree with you. I'd be more interested yeah. in that. Yeah.
I'd be more stoked if yeah. I was like, oh, what? What do you mean? There's going to be a surprise. Is it Stone Cold? Like, oh, my God. I would be freaking out. Yeah. You know?
Well, now I think ultimately... I think that rumor has cooled a little bit. It's just not as prevalent online. I'm not sure that's really going to go down. Of course, yes, The Rock has been rumored to be in the main event next year at WrestleMania, which will be in Los Angeles. We'll see how that goes. But let's move on. Today's Nothing Worthwhile podcast, season one of Peacemaker, is brought to you by New U Life Center. New U Life Center is growing. Woo! Check them out in Phoenix at 4515 North 16th Street, Suite 105. That's Phoenix, Arizona, 85016. Give Maria a call at 602-274-0068. Check them out at their website, www.newulifecenters.com. That's N-U-Y-O-U, lifecenters.com. Get one of their wonderful laser treatments. Restore youthfulness with confidence. Life-changing solutions mm-hmm. tailored to your goals. That's New U Life Center. Guys, I have one question for you. Do you really want to taste it?
All of it.
Oh, man. I knew you were going to do this to me. This is my favorite part
watching,
of the show.
They're watching the opener to Peacemaker.
Yeah.
This is the best great. Opening to any
this
show
really is.
Ever.
It really is.
When I saw it first
when I what? Yeah, the first when I saw this for the first time, I was like, all right.
It's so this campy, but I love how serious they take the dancing.
Oh my
I
god. Mean, the choreography is just great though.
And they
oh
get everybody god. Involved. Every character, even yep. the yep. small characters are involved.
Even the judo master.
Yeah. Nut Lee.
It's gonna yep. be very difficult for me to like hide my opinions. Because right now I'm watching like what is like.
All right, so let me ask you guys. You're watching an opener like this as a viewer. What's the sense you're gonna get with the show?
Serious, but comedy, awesome, dry humor, sarcastic, asshole, like all of the above for me.
Groot, what'd you think of the opener? It sets the stage for the viewing experience.
It tells me that this is going to be. It tells me that this is going to be something I've never seen before, and it also mm-hmm. tells me that everybody I'm looking at is in on the joke, that yep. and they're taking it seriously. They're sort of winking at the audience, but they're saying, "Listen, mm-hmm. trust us. This is going to be fun. It's going to be weird. It's going to be crazy. Just you know, give us a chance, and we'll show you." And that's how I felt. I was like, they drew me in immediately. With that opener,
you know, when I was a principal, they always talked about the building having curbside appeal. When you pull up that first view of the school, the cleanliness, this, that, and the other thing. I mean, here it's so unique. I mean, you're just drawn to the whole opener, and I think as a viewer, I agree with everything you said. It's sardonic but serious. You know, you're going to get some campiness, but you know it's going to be serious. Like I think as a viewer, it just sets the stage really nicely.
And it reminded me of something else because number one, you gotta, you know, you can have the greatest opening in the world, but you gotta have something behind it to keep people coming back. Otherwise, they'll just keep YouTubing the opening and just watching that when they need a fix. So you gotta be good at it. It reminds me of another TV show that I became a lifelong fan of just because I liked the opening. I watched the opening thing, and that was Dallas. I loved that opening thing that they did, you know, on that show. And then I started watching some of the episodes, and then I was hooked. So, like, it just shows you. And if you haven't noticed, I'm sure you have, in recent days, TV shows, they don't have those iconic openings anymore. They try to get right into it because they don't.
There's no where everybody knows your name anymore.
There's none of that.
No, and I feel like in the early 2000s they shortened the presentation leading up to the shows.
Yeah,
and I think maybe now they're kind of going back to that eye catching. Let me try to get the openers for these shows.
Yeah,
Game of Thrones. These things are very detailed, and it's almost like. I think of Ozark on Netflix. They almost lead into the episode. There's Easter eggs and different things that the viewers can catch. So I agree, Gru. I think they're moving more towards these more intricate openers to catch the viewer's eye.
Well, it works here. So
definitely.
Well, guys, before we get into Peacemaker, you know, everybody talks about the MCU, the Marvel comic universe of movies. I wanted to get everybody's thoughts on DC, the DCU, the DC Comics, and the film universe. We know that Peacemaker is a part of it. I'll go first to Monique. overall, up until this point, what did you think of the DC Comics, the films, and what they presented to viewers so far?
Well, this is just, of course, my opinion. DC in general. Leading up to, of course, Peacemaker, not so great, in my opinion. I was very disappointed with a couple of movies that were coming out that just, they were too... listen, I get the concept. I understand what you're trying to do. But if you're trying to catch up so hard to Marvel, you're doing it wrong. Okay? Doing it majorly wrong. See... The difference is that Marvel took its time, okay, releasing each and every movie of each Avenger. If you think about it, DC was just like, forget it. We're going to put Ben Affleck as Batman. We're going to do Batman versus Superman with no reason as to why the hell we're doing that. And then we're going to make a Suicide Squad that's just not that great. And then we're going to do Justice League with all characters that nobody really knows about. Like, no, who's Cyborg? You know what I mean? No buildup to these characters. And it's just like, that's not what I was loving. I was like, listen, the reason why and Marvel's doing better than you is because they built it up. We didn't know this villain in DC in Justice League. Who the hell is that? Who's this guy? You know, why is it so important? And I think DC at the time wasn't doing their best. They were just half-assing it. And they were just not in the right set of mind to keep just pushing. I felt like it was being shoved down our throats.
Andrew Gruthius. Moni, not too much of a fan. Gru, what are your thoughts on the DCU up to this point?
Could not agree more with what Moni said. I feel exactly the same way. Because you have to stack it up against Marvel. There's no other...
Yes.
That you can't not.
Right.
And if you look how Marvel started their MCU, they started with Iron Man. A simple story, okay, sort of... Welcoming us into this thing.
Actually, okay. They started with the Incredible Hulk with Edward Norton. But
was that before? Was that before Iron? No, that was after. Correct. Iron Man. Because Tony Stark came in at the end of that. At the end,
Incredible Hulk.
The original Hulk with Eric Bana.
No, that was
first.
I think the Edward Norton Hulk was before.
No,
Iron Man.
I'm telling you, it wasn't at the very end of that movie.
Thunderbolt Thaddeus Ross,
right, and Tony Stark, who we already know from Iron Man. So
let's not split hairs off my ball.
But 100%, 100%, I can tell you with 100% certainty that Iron Man was first, and that's what sort of began this MCU. DC started with Man of Steel, pretty much, and they wanted to blow everything out of the water. they basically told the same exact story as the original Superman with Christopher Reeve. They just decided to dial it up to 11 and be as loud and be as crazy and shift forward and backwards and sideways in time so nobody knew what the hell was going on. So it was like a kitchen sink affair right out of the gate, and they stumbled. And each of the movies have been kind of like that. They've been too much. I mean, Justice League put out two Justice Leagues within a year of each other. You know,
like, so it's funny you mention that because I was on HBO Max. They have the Snyder Cut, and now they have a Snyder Cut Gray edition, like another 4-hour jam. So, listening to your comments, I also agree with both you guys. I think the one move that DC did that helped them was they went away from trying to compete with the shared universe concept, and their standalone movies. Some of them have not been good, but some of them have been good. I think, you know, Aquaman was pretty decent. Shazam was pretty decent. I did not like the second Wonder Woman, but the first Wonder Woman was really good. Mm-hmm. So I think once they tried to stop competing per se with that concept that Marvel really has done such a great job with, and they just, you know, are telling stories, you know, the Joker, we have the new Batman movie coming up. I think this, they're starting to freshen up the product, but I agree with you. Initially, Let's just try to jam everything out there and catch up with the Marvel Universe. I don't think they helped themselves, but I think the recent shift to standalone DC comic movies have done them better.
Yeah, I think I agree with you. Go ahead, Mony.
Yeah. Sorry. No, you started talking.
Well, I was just going to say how, like, Peacemaker is an example of that. This really doesn't have much. It has connection to Suicide Squad, but not much else. It's on its own merit. But Marvel is interesting because they have all these TV shows, but they're able to connect them. Like, not so much that you need to have seen all of these other things, but for those who have, this is there for them. DC is like, you have to go in knowing way too much. Mm-hmm. And now all of a sudden, you know, look, if you ask me who the best Batman is, I would say Michael Keaton. So I'm excited for him to come back into this. But it doesn't make sense that there's going to be that you have this new Batman movie that's coming out next week. Then Ben Affleck apparently is in the same Batman movie as Michael Keaton. I'm like, what are they doing? Like, relax, take it easy. You know, it's a bit much.
Going off of that, my favorite Batman, I that's awesome, Michael Keaton. Absolutely. Would love to see him back as, you know, Bruce Wayne. Love it. But of course, my generation Batman was Christian Bale. I thought Christopher Nolan really did his duty of giving us a trilogy that was absolutely amazing. The storyline fit perfectly to what he wanted to do. It was beautiful. I thought, oh my gosh, DC's doing it. This is happening. You know, fell in love with all the villains and everything, and then all of a sudden it just went to shit. You're like, what just happened?
What do you mean it went to shit?
If
after, you know, the trilogy of Batman, they came
because I love the Dark Knight Rises. I love that.
No. What I meant was the trilogy. You know, Christopher Nolan did his trilogy, and then after that, you know, Man of Steel, Batman versus Superman came out. It's like, what are we doing?
Well, I have a question then. I have a question for both of you. All right, go ahead. Go ahead, Evan.
I actually disagree because they ruined it when they went to Christopher Nolan. I like the Joel Schumacher homoerotic Val Kilmer with the big cock.
The nipples. Okay, the nipples.
Evan, there's no time for your jokes here.
Real quick, I want to stick to Peacemaker-ness. But
I like the bat nipples. I like the bat nipples. My question is this, though. Why is it, if I think we're agreed, the best thing that the DC has done is that Christopher Nolan trilogy. I think that as far as movies go, I mean, the guy won two Academy Awards, I think. But in any case, why aren't they, like, for example, in the DC Batman now, why aren't they using the same, why are they pretending that trilogy doesn't exist? Like, why isn't Michael Caine, Alfred, Christian Bale wants to return or not, if he doesn't want it, that's fine. Right. But why are they making that a whole separate thing when that's the best thing that they've done?
They're standalone movies, and they've now all taken in this concept of the multiverse and multiple universes. And so now they could, this is why you could see the, you know, these comic books sort of exist in infinitum, because you just take Batman, you give it to a new character, a new director, and whatever their vision is how it goes down. And you could always do a nostalgic callback to whatever the old Batman is. And even in the comics, Batman passed it off to this one. And, you know, I have not been a much of a comic fan lately, but in my early youth, you know, Peter Parker gave the Spider-Man suit to this one. So, you know, there's ways of continuing these franchises sort of forever in this multiple universe concept.
Well, I was going to ask off that. What did both of you think of how Marvel did their kind of multiverse thing with the three Spider-Mans and all that.
Can we state it?
I'm just saying because it kind of.
Well, here's my thing. I'll just say this real quick. I'm not a fan of the multiverse. I'm not a fan of time loop. I'm not a fan because now you could sort of, which it may be exciting for viewers. It's confusing for me to follow. You can get all these nostalgia callbacks, I believe, in Doctor Strange and all the stuff like this. But it just, to me, it allows for now lazy writing.
Yep. You can write yourself out of anything.
There's no stakes, as you like to say,
because there's
multiple universes. So this is where the next phase of Marvel movies are going. I'm sure I'll enjoy them because I'm a fan of the, you know, MCU, and I'm a fan of most of the movies, not all of them. Eternals was just straight garbage, hot garbage.
Didn't see it
originally.
But nonetheless, that's my feelings. Mony, what do you think of this whole multiverse concept that they're sort of picking up on?
I thought it was great.
There's the generational age difference.
Well, I loved it.
You know, I just, it made sense to me because, like I said, with the MCU, they know how to pick and choose a storyline and go with it, and it makes sense. So with this movie, of course, you know, No Way Home that came out, beautiful. Oh my God. I was literally, and introducing characters that, you know, Marvel, obviously, I don't know if you guys, Marvel does shows as well on Netflix, mm-hmm. you know, Daredevil, Jessica Jones, Iron Fist, you know, all those.
Yep.
And seeing those characters as well in this was just, oh, it was so great. Yes, it can lead to lazy writing, absolutely, but, you know, I don't care. It's Marvel, and I love it, because it's the same storyline. It's continuing.
Yeah.
It's not making up and stopping, casting a new person, making up a whole new, you know, movie storyline, being like, you gotta like it or else, you know, go screw off somewhere else. No, it's continuing. So that's just my opinion.
All right, let's move on to back to DC. Let's pivot, please. This is a DC podcast.
Pivot.
We'll go to Gru first. Gru, you are a wrestling fan. You are familiar with John Cena. Before you even saw Peacemaker season one and you heard James Gunn, Peacemaker, John Cena. We did watch the trailer together on one of our older podcasts.
Mm-hmm.
What were your thoughts leading into viewing season one of Peacemaker? Well, excited? What'd you think?
Well, I don't remember what I said on the podcast, and what I say now might not match up with it. But if I'm being honest, I didn't think anything of it. I was like, all right, this is going to be another one of those, you know, the Marine Five. Now instead of Cena, it's going to mm-hmm. be with The Miz or Kane. It's going to be one of these more WWE produced straight to VOD kind of things that nobody sees yet somehow make all the
even
money.
When you heard James Gunn was involved,
I don't even know who James Gunn is. Well, I didn't then.
Okay.
I honestly didn't.
Exactly, Mony. Exactly.
Yeah, I didn't. I'm sorry.
Get off this podcast. It's just going to be Evan and
I've been trying to get off this podcast for months.
How dare you? Let's pivot. Mony, what did you think when you first heard Peacemaker? I know you're a little bit of a wrestling fan. I'm sure you know of John Cena, James Gunn,
season one
of Peacemaker. What were your thoughts before you even saw the first episode?
Yeah. Well, of course I knew about John Cena because that's my son's favorite wrestler.
That is true. I did get him a shirt at the WrestleMania store.
Oh, that's who that was for? John Cena.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, yep. That's who it's for.
Yep, it was for Lane.
Were you excited for season one? What did you think?
Okay, so when I saw the trailer, because when you were talking about, you know, doing this podcast, I was like, I haven't heard of it, so what's going on? So I found the trailer and when I saw written and directed by James Gunn, I thought, oh, this is gonna be great.
Well, can you tell me about it? Can you educate me a little bit about him?
James Gunn? Absolutely, yeah. I can. Where do we have the time? Let's go back from the beginning. He was born on... I'm
just no, no, I mean, like, I feel yeah, like I we, should
we
know.
3 hours. Let's
yeah.
Moni, give him the abridged quick version of
absolutely.
What about James Gunn
is actually a director. He directed, actually directing all three of the Guardians of the Galaxy movies. He also written and directed The Suicide Squad, where, of course, Peacemaker was introduced. Mm-hmm. James Gunn also produced so many great movies in his time, Brightburn being one of them. His brothers actually wrote and directed that. He was an executive producer on that one. I don't know if you've seen Brightburn. Such a great movie. Love the spin of having a dark Superman. But yeah, so that's James Gunn. He's actually involved in a lot of great masterpieces, I think, in my opinion.
You had me at Guardians of the Galaxy. I didn't know that. So okay. Here's another guy who's went from Marvel to DC. Like the other guy, like what's his name, Whedon, Joss Whedon. He did the same thing. All right, I should have known that.
No, ironically, Josh Whedon's about to get himself canceled, and they tried to cancel James Gunn.
Did they?
He's so darn talented that he pushed through it, and he's back.
What did they have on him?
He had tweets that were, you know, he cracked about some inappropriate stuff, maybe 2004, 2050, before everything got super, super duper serious. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they tried. I think he laid low for a little bit. They pulled him off Guardians 3, but now he's back onto the project. He did Brightburn. I think that sort of got him back into the flow, and now he's solid A-list stuff. I mean, you know, again, I don't want to overdwell, but Guardians, I really enjoyed the first one. But here's the key: I super enjoyed the second one. You know, that's a good director when you enjoy the sequel.
When you enjoy the sequel.
Yep. All right, guys, let's go to Peacemaker. That's an American television series. It was created by one James Gunn for the streaming service HBO Max, based off of the DC Comics character Peacemaker. It is the first DC Extended Universe television series. And a spinoff, as Mony said, from the 2021 film The Suicide Squad. Set after the events of the film, it follows killer Christopher Smith, a.k.a. Peacemaker, as he joins Project Butterfly, a black ops squad that targets parasitic butterfly-like aliens. James Gunn conceived Peacemaker, guys, after noting John Cena's strength as a dramatic actor while filming Suicide Squad. James Gunn wrote, for the most part, all 8 episodes while completing the film during the COVID-19 pandemic. HBO Max ordered Peacemaker straight to series in September 2020. An additional casting took place over the following months. Filming took place in Vancouver, Canada from January to July of 2021, with Gunn directing 5 out of the 8 season 1 episodes. Why did James Gunn choose Peacemaker, a DC Universe character, for his foray into episodic television? Well, courtesy of DigitalSpy.com, Suicide Squad director James Gunn has specified why he made Peacemaker TV spinoff, which explores the origins of John Cena's muscle-bound anti-hero and his questionable world-saving antics post-Suicide Squad. James Gunn was quoted as saying, quote, number one, I really got along with John Cena. We became really good friends. He's a funny guy, and I thought it would be fun to continue working with him. I also thought that a lot of the characters we saw in The Suicide Squad, we saw big changes in them. Ratchcatcher 2 changed a lot. Bloodsport changed a lot. Polka Dot Man changed a lot. Peacemaker kind of remained that unrepentant SOB that he was at the beginning of the movie, and I knew there was a lot deeper to go with the character. John and I had talked about where the character came from, who he was, who his father was, and all of these different things that we didn't get to see in the movie. So I knew there was a lot more story to explore. Peacemaker, he took advantage of the small screen format. I do think that the TV format, it brings you a lot more freedom that film doesn't allow. Film is so short, you have to keep that plot going from scene to scene. Quote, in the Peacemaker show, we were able to take a lot of risks, a lot of chances, explore dramatic elements that we weren't able to do in the movie, explore comedy in a way that we weren't able to do. It's really just everything I love, comedy, drama, action, all in one TV series that doesn't take itself too seriously, but in other ways takes itself very seriously. So I'll take a pause, guys. Thoughts on what James Gunn described as the impetus for Peacemaker and the real appreciation of the actor, not the wrestler, John Cena.
Mony, go ahead.
Somebody.
Oh, okay. Sure. Let me kick it off. No, well, like I said, well, being introduced to John Cena as the Peacemaker in Suicide Squad, I really thought, okay, this guy's really fit for this role. Really impressed me with, one, the way he was able to develop, you know, the way that he was portrayed. I loved it. The character development was great, in my opinion. And yeah, it was quite spectacular.
So watching the Suicide Squad, and they decided to go with Peacemaker as a spinoff, did you think, were you surprised at that character, or do you think that was the right character beyond a John Cena, the right character to sort of...
It was the right character. It was literally, I couldn't see anyone else. You know, that was just that's my opinion. I couldn't see anyone else to pick, to pull, to do a spinoff. You know, he had everything that was given to, you know, James Gunn to kind of be like, you know what, let's choose this guy because I feel like we can do more with this guy. The other characters were great, don't get me wrong, but I felt like he could have, yes, he was right. He'd do more. There was more to Peacemaker than just, you know, what we saw in the Suicide Squad.
Gru, it sounds like James Gunn is a real appreciation of John Cena, the actor. Any thoughts, you know, in regards to
that? Yeah, well, I have to full disclosure, I did not see the Suicide Squad.
My Lord. How dare you?
I didn't see it.
I'm so busy. Oh, my God. How do you ask?
But in a way, I was thankful because this thing was completely fresh to me. The character, the ideas, okay. All of it was brand new. So, you know, that was a true test. Everything that you said about James Gunn right there tells me he's trying to move forward. He's trying to break new ground. He's trying to give us something different that we haven't seen before. That tells me everything I need to know about the ambition behind the Peacemaker and what they're trying to do. In fact, you know, you said it, Evan. He's trying to not do the same old stuff that seemed to be just repeating itself with Batman and Batman versus Superman and this, that. He's trying to really take it in a new direction. So even if it failed, it's still admirable to try and do that.
Right.
Which is, you know, which too many people are afraid to do. They just need that safety net.
The thing I got also from the comments was, you know, I wrote into my notes, he sounds like he actually has a real appreciation for John Cena as an actor.
Yes.
And right. I've said on prior podcasts, again, and we talked a little bit earlier, obviously John Cena will be compared to Dwayne The Rock Johnson and Dave Bautista. These are the three former pro wrestlers that have really hit mainstream as an actor. And I think Cena has the highest ceiling as an actor. I don't mean in popularity. I mean, I think this is the guy that can deliver the greatest performance on screen. I think he's the most connected as an actor. And it was nice to read that James Gunn appreciated this guy as an actor, not just a muscle-bound wrestler.
You read you read my mind, because what I was going to say was, I see, whenever I watch a Dwayne Johnson movie, I always see The Rock. Always. He can't get past, like, he just can't seem to get past it. He's The Rock. When I saw Peacemaker, I wasn't watching John Cena. That's how I felt. And who was the other person you mentioned? You mentioned somebody else.
Dave Bautista.
Yes. When I watch Guardians of the Galaxy, I see Drax. I don't see Bautista.
Right.
You know, those guys are, maybe their lack of being, maybe them not being the biggest movie star in the world is helping them sort of, because when Rock started, he flew right to the top. You know, and that's who he is. He's not really going, but it's working for him. He's a billionaire, so do what works. But what you said about that high ceiling, Cena is an actor. I really believe that. I believe John Cena. I wouldn't have said that before. I say it now. John Cena is an actor. I don't know if I would call Dwayne Johnson a master thespian just yet.
You know, I actually agree.
And he kicked my ass, but
I'm not going to sit there and say we'll see John Cena in 5 years nominated for an Oscar. But I'm being honest; it would not surprise me.
I could see an Emmy coming from this. I think he's.
I know that he's looking. I know he's looking. I believe I read he signed on for a pretty serious dramatic role, and I'm actually looking forward to seeing what he could do in a. In a straight, serious drama piece as well.
Yeah, and he obviously, look at that opening segment. He's putting 1,000% into this. He's not just showing up to work and saying, what do I say? Where do I go? Okay, all right, let me get on the phone here. Oh, yeah, we got a commercial for, that's what Dwayne Johnson does. He's got 19 other businesses besides.
Yeah, but hold on. But I think these wrestlers, including Dwayne Johnson, I think being a wrestler gives you an incredible work ethic. You're on the road 300 days a year. So, I mean, I would expect all three guys, including The Rock, that these guys are grinders, and I think they're not afraid to put themselves completely in a pocket.
But my point is that Cena, at least what's proven to me so far, is that he is 1,000% in on this thing. He's got nothing else. This is his primary focus. I watched Jungle Cruise over the summer. And it was a fun movie, but it didn't matter who was in it. It didn't matter. It could have been Indiana Jones. It could have been anybody. It just happened to be Dwayne Johnson. And he was fine. Nothing special. He was fine. He's fun to watch. But he's, like I said, he's got so many other, like he's filming three movies at the same time. He's doing the Young Rock. He's got a little bit of himself into so many different things. How can you really throw everything you've got into one thing when you have so much going on? And that's, to me, that is what Cena seems to have been able to do here.
Well, let me tell you something.
I knew that was coming.
All right, guys. The premise of Peacemaker is recovering from his injuries he suffered during the events of the Suicide Squad. Christopher Smith, a.k.a. Peacemaker, is forced to join the mysterious Argus Black Ops Squad, Project Butterfly. They're on a mission to identify and eliminate parasitic butterfly-like creatures in human form in the United States and around the world. Guys, Peacemaker literally starts where the Suicide Squad ends. Any thoughts on the setup for the Peacemaker television series?
Well,
we're going to watch the Suicide Squad.
Yeah, go ahead, Mony.
It set it up perfectly for guys like me who did not. If everyone who was watching the show had seen the Suicide Squad, why would they need to do a recap? They did it for idiots like me. So I went into, as soon as the Peacemaker started after the recap, I'm like, okay, I just saved myself 2.5 hours. I know exactly what's going on. So, you know what I mean? So, it set it up, to answer the question, it set it up perfectly.
It makes sense. It was actually great of, Gunn to do that, to where it's like, let's take about 2 minutes at the end of the Suicide Squad, kind of give them, where we left off, starting. Because if you were to just start off by him just being in the hospital, be like, what happened? What happened? You know what I mean? There's that gap. So it was great for them to put that in there to be like, okay, this is what happened. This is why he's starting here. This is why, he kind of feels like he's on the run, but he's not. You know what I mean? So I like that. You're right, Gru. It was perfect for idiots like you that didn't watch the Suicide Squad. And just decided to watch
Peacemaker. That's actually the name of our new podcast.
Yeah. Idiots like us.
Idiots like us, guys.
No, but I actually love the fact that it picks up literally minutes after. Yep. I'm thinking, I loved Rocky II. It was right after the first fight. I don't like 6 months later, 2 years later. Right. It's picking up right when he's in the hospital recovering from his injuries. Thought that was pretty, pretty cool. Mm-hmm. And, of course, I love the whole when they do the x-ray and he's worried about his back muscles looking small.
Yeah.
X-ray.
This does not make me feel confident.
Yeah, like his traps. So,
Can I ask a question first? As far as the type of, because you will continue to point out, I did not see either Suicide Squad. So what is the difference or similarities in tone, in style, in language? Because this obviously goes for the adult crowd. Is that kind of what Suicide did as well? Or are they doubling down on that with this and taking it even further? That's my question. I don't know the answer.
If you, a comparison to the first one, it's a sequel and sort of a reboot. And yes, the same elements in the Peacemaker series, at least my opinion. I'll toss it to Mony in a second. But it's sardonic with a wink, but it's serious. It's humor, but it's adult. And
what about the language?
It's salty. Yeah. It's adult laden. And I enjoyed the Suicide Squad. I thought the opener was just absolutely fantastic. It hooks you right into the movie. It's a little bit of a surprise, actually, even. So I enjoyed the Suicide Squad, and I think it's the same element and tone as the Peacemaker series. Mony,
is that the second one or the first one?
It's the second one.
Okay. So the first one is just called Suicide Squad. The second one is The Suicide Squad. Just like The Batman.
I got you.
So those are the difference. But yes, it has the same tone. I agree with Evan 100%. Same tone. I mean, the F word is like their first language. Just like the Peacemaker. So nothing changed really. It was the same. Absolutely.
Let's take a quick gander at the cast of Peacemaker Season 1. John Cena, of course, as the title role. Christopher Smith, a.k.a. Peacemaker. Freddie Stroma as Adrian Chase, a.k.a. Vigilante. Jennifer Holland as Agent Amelia Harcourt. Robert Patrick as Dad Augie Smith. Lachlan Monroe as Cop Larry Fitzgibbons. Danielle Brooks from Orange is the New Black as Leota Adebayo. Chuck Woody Awuje as Clemson Mern, Steve Agee as John Economos, Annie Chang as Detective Sophie Song, D.D. Bradley Baker as the voice of Eagly, and of course, Newt Lee as Judo Master. Guys, another TV series with a very expansive, well-balanced cast. Any thoughts on the casting for Peacemaker Season 1?
My thought was it was absolutely perfectly executed. I mean, they didn't change anyone. They kind of kept, you know, of course, Harcourt the same, of course, from the Suicide Squad. Gru has no idea what I'm talking about, but we'll get to that in a second.
Economos as well.
Yeah, of course, Dyebeard. You have to have Dyebeard in there. Economos, same in the Suicide Squad. It was great. The casting is beautifully done. If you don't mind, Evan, can you tell me Mern's name again? Because his name is so, like...
Yeah, it's and I hope I get it right. Chuck Woody Awuje?
Awuje, okay. Because, yeah. No, his name is beautiful. It's just like, how do I pronounce that?
Yeah.
Awuje. Yeah, he was perfectly casted as Mern. I thought, well done. But yeah, I love the cast. They did great.
Gru, what'd you think of the cast?
Agreed. And it's a testament to... that they really worked hard. They must have really worked hard at casting the Suicide Squad because everybody in there, a lot of times they try to, you know, when they got a big star out front, that's where they spend all their money. So they kind of like cheap it up with the supporting cast. They figure they'll ride on the good nature of their star. And here they kind of, with the exception of Robert Patrick, I'd never heard of any of these people. And yet, they were all spectacular. Usually when you have new people or people that are not well-known character actors or well-known performers, you know, they don't have a kind of chemistry that you need, you know. And it happens, like Marvel casts really, I mean, they have the money to, you know, have A-list movie stars in every single part. DC doesn't do that, or at least not with this, but they have the right people. Like, these people embody these characters. It's going to be like X-Men. When X-Men started, nobody knew who these people were. Now they're the only people who could play those roles. I see the same thing happening with this cast here. They're all great. I really enjoyed
it. I agree with both.
Even the guy, I know, I just, because I'm remembering things. Think of one of the first scenes in the first episode. When he's coming out of the hospital, the janitor. That was one of the funniest. I'd never seen that guy before. I never seen that actor before. And him and John Cena are going mano a mano for 5 minutes with this great writing and this great chemistry. I'm like, where are they getting this from? This scene is amazing. And I'm like, this is casting. This is how you do it. You don't just bring in the most talented person. You bring in who is going to work best for this scene with these actors, And that's what they did here. And that was, you know, that what a way to open that show. I just wanted to add that in there. I'm sorry.
If any, absolutely. Do you want to add anything else, Andy?
No, not yet. Okay. Not now.
Now, what I would say is I agree with everything you guys said. A television series, when you're able to create that universe and when the star is off screen and you don't seem to mind because you're interested in the other actors yes. and actresses, you talk about Cobra Kai. I'm not going to compare the two per se, but this cast, Adebayo, Harcourt, Economos, they're such interesting characters. And when Cena, the main guy, is not on the screen, there's no drop off. The writing is so strong that they,
right.
you know, I could watch a spinoff of just Adebayo and her life and the mother yes. and Waller. Again, I don't want to, you know, overplay it, but I thought it was that interesting. I thought it was that interesting, the cast. I agree. It just seems like they took their time and casted very well here. And I think the writing, James Gunn, able to just give everyone sort of their own personality and create it quick. You know, get you know, everyone's sort of nuances quick and off we go with the show.
It actually reminded
speaking
me.
Speaking of casting. Oh.
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, no, speaking of the casting, I don't know if you guys know this, but James Gunn actually brought Iuje Mern to act in Guardians of the Galaxy 3. So he's actually one of the characters Ooh. In Guardians of the Galaxy 3. Mm. He literally like, was like, I need you to come and be in this movie.
This is becoming like the Monday Night Wars, Evan. Marvel versus DC.
So perhaps.
Going to be yes, the Forbidden in this Door. Movie. So he like casted him to be in Guardians of the Galaxy 3. I thought that was great. I was like, oh, yay, like, going to see Mern, you know, in the third part. So that's cool.
Well, I feel like even more of an idiot because I should know who James Gunn is because the writing in this show reminded me of my current favorite screenwriter, and that's Aaron Sorkin. The way he writes, not necessarily yes. like the political slants, but the type of dialogue, the speed, you know, like the dialogue cannot be said without chemistry, like it's impossible,
right.
And so this was such a great marriage of writing and chemistry with actors, so you know, and it reminded me of Sorkin's best stuff,
yeah.
Well, guys, Peacemaker Season 1 was released in the U.S. on January 13, 2022. A tagline, give peace an effing chance. It's an action-adventure comedy. It's certified TV mature. You want to take a brief spin into the episodes?
Sure.
Let's do it.
Go for
All
it.
Right. Episode 1 starts off 5 months after the mission with the Suicide Squad and Quarto Maltese. Christopher Smith is recovering from his injuries. He has suffered. He's discharged from the hospital. Upon returning to his trailer home, Smith is confronted by a group of Argus agents, Clemson Mern, Amelia Harcourt, John Economos, and newcomer Leota Adebayo. Mern gives him a choice. You can either go back to prison or join us on this new mission, a.k.a. Project Butterfly. Christopher Smith reluctantly accepts. He goes to visit his dad, Augie, to retrieve his pet, Eagly, and acquire his new outfit. He has a team. Has dinner with the team, and Mern gives him a dossier of his assassination target. Christopher Smith attempts to flirt with Harcourt in a bar, but is rejected. Instead, goes home with a different woman at the bar, Annie Sterfazen. Adebayo privately discusses her role in Project Butterfly with her mother, Argus leader Amanda Waller. Sterfazen attacks Christopher Smith and reveals that she has superhuman strength. In the ensuing fight, Smith activates a sonic boom weapon in his helmet that kills her. Guys, episode 1, which, by the way, was titled A Whole New World, written and directed by James Gunn. All right, let's get to it. What'd you guys, any thoughts on the opening episode, episode number 1 for Peacemaker?
Well, this reminded me of that beautiful scene in the movie Harlem Nights. When after Eddie Murphy has sex with Jasmine Guy, he blows her head off. You don't really see that too often. You saw it here.
Yes, thank you.
I'm surprised you didn't include that in the thing. I mean, that to me was one of the funniest parts of this episode.
Well, I think one of the things that when you make that comment, Gunn did say that they were not going to hold back. They're going to use
yeah.
language They dropped the F word and not F-U-C-K a couple of times in this movie. They were going to try to get as real as possible, even in today's day and age of cancel culture. So I think James Gunn is not afraid to sort of go there with semi-shocking stuff or stuff that might offend people today, so to speak.
But but that's the thing. It didn't seem shocking. It seemed appropriate. And that's why I liked it so much.
I understand.
Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah, so it was great. It was good.
Mony, what'd you think of the first episode?
Oh, I that's what hooked me. I think it was like the first 10, 15 minutes of that show where I was like, oh, I'm going to love this. Oh, I'm going to love this. Mm-hmm. I think just Peacemaker, it was so realistic, too, if you think about it.
That's what happens. After I'm with somebody and I do something, they just disappear. They and just go also, away forever.
At the bar, he's telling Harcourt, he goes, I've been in prison for 4 years, okay? You cannot blame me if I'm just trying to stick it in somewhere, okay? You cannot blame me. And that's so true, and I love that realistic aspect of it, and that's why I think it was just the beautiful writing of it was awesome. And also the chemistry, that fight scene in the bar was, oh, I knew the action was going to be awesome, because just that scene itself, I was like, yes, that's what I'm talking about. And second, like I said, the realistic reality of it all. And of course, you know, with the beautiful line from Myrne of course you screw a butterfly. You, out of all people, would screw a butterfly and have to kill it and then almost blow our cover. You know what I mean? So it's like, it was perfect. A great first episode.
I love the lines. Go ahead, Evan.
What did you think of the reveal of Adebayo being Amanda Waller's daughter?
Didn't shock me, to be honest. I felt like there was when it comes down to like these types of shows, okay, when it comes down to like superhero aspect, there's always a mole. There's always that one person, you know, that is like kind of going behind their backs, but not really. They don't want to, but they have to. You know what I mean? And that's her mother. So it didn't surprise me, but at the same time, I was like, oh, come on. I liked you, Adebayo. Come on. This sucks. So
Really made me laugh, or a couple lines that really made me laugh, were when they were talking about the names of the projects. And Cena and the Peacemaker was like, you guys are not very creative with your names. It's like Project Butterfly is actually about killing butterflies. What was the other one? He's like, last time we did, you know, like, and he's like, am I fighting Mothra?
Project Starfish.
Yeah, Starfish, yeah.
Starfish.
That's hilarious. That's absolutely hilarious. I was laughing hysterically at that. So great.
You know, and Adebayo, kind of like, I feel like she's my spirit animal, because that scene when they are introducing themselves and she's just rambling and rambling.
Oh yeah, I don't know if I should be making a speech, but I'm doing it anyway. Yeah.
I was like, that is me. That is me 110%. She's my spirit animal.
I remembered her from The Orange is the New Black. The actress Danielle Brooks. And she's really good. Really good here. I enjoyed her performance as Adebayo. Let's move on to episode 2, Best Friends for Never, written and directed by James Gunn. Peacemaker contacts Harcourt and explains his situation as Evergreen's police force arrives to investigate the sonic boom. While collecting his things, Christopher Smith comes across a mysterious device in Sturfhausen's apartment. Smith briefly takes a couple hostage in the apartment complex and is able to escape from the apartment's balcony, getting away with Eagly, Harcourt, and Adebayo. Police detectives Sophie Song and Larry Fitzgibbon investigate Starfousand's death. They arrest Augie after Economo switches Smith's fingerprints for his in the police system, and Adebayo bribes the couple into identifying Augie as the man who took them hostage. In prison, we get the reveal that Augie is the White Dragon, as a group of white inmates, you know, sort of hail him. Smith realizes that Sturfhausen only tried to attack him after reading the dossier he had on his assassination target and tells the team. Feeling shunned by them, Smith returns to his trailer and greeted by his one-time crime-fighting partner, Vigilante. Great character. Vigilante invites Smith to target practice to raise his spirits with him and discovers that the device from Sturfhausen's apartment is a miniature spaceship. Episode 2, Best Friends for Never. Guys, what'd you think?
Well, it introduced my favorite character of the whole season.
Was it Vigilante? Yeah, he is pretty cool. Yeah.
I'm sorry. I would love to have a friend like that. When they were,
I imagined Evan and I sitting like in a theater, like back in 1993, in the reveal of that threesome of Evan and I just punching each other, laughing so hard. It's like, what, where could they possibly go with this? And then you just see Vigilante lying there still with his mask on. And I'm like, this is one of the funniest things. But, Robert Patrick has one of my favorite line readings I've ever heard. When he's getting arrested, his reaction when they tell him who he
what does he say?
He says, "Who the fuck is that?" That's what he says. Like when they say, "You're on," I forgot who he was being arrested. I'm sorry. I literally saw this for the first time over the last 2 weeks, so I'm not remembering every nook and cranny. But you know, whenever they tell they knocked on his door and he's like, "What the hell are you guys doing here? You're under arrest for so and so." He's like, "Who the fuck is that?" And then he just looks at the other cop, like, and he's walking in, he's like, "Fuck you." You know, I love it. I just, like, number one, Robert Patrick is just a great actor. But yeah, what he does with those lines, he is eating them up. Like, it's awesome.
And it's just great because, like, what we're going back to, Evan said it, to where James Gunn kind of broke, you know, just stare of, like, they're going all in. They're going all in. Doesn't matter how hurt your feelings are. This is, we're in 2022. This shit is real. Mm-hmm. So it's like when Augie come to find out he's actually a freaking racist, you know, not exactly the most nicest white dude you'll probably ever meet if you're ethnic. I mean, Detective Song got like the, you know, all of the insults.
Yeah. He dropped a couple of Asian lines.
A couple Asian lines in there. And I thought that was so great because it was just, it's real. You know what I mean? It's real.
So is the way not to be canceled to be self-aware? Because they do make mention of that. They do, like, the cops do say he's racist, he's this, that. Is that like the band-aid where, okay, now that we've told the world that we're going to be racist, is it okay for us to do, like it almost feels like that, and that's fine with me, you know?
Well, here's the thing. Right. Here's what I'll say with that. I believe in the actual comic, his dad is the White Dragon.
Correct.
Yes.
It's organic to the story. So I think, you know, Andrew and I talk about on a lot of different movies and television shows, you know, this sort of kind of wokeness here, or there's elements where really we don't think it applies here. I'll give it a pass because it doesn't feel overly preachy. It feels like it kind of fits into the organic story of the show. I mean,
it's part of Peacemaker's past too.
That's what I'm saying. It's part of the actual comic
story. It's a story. And I'm sorry, but like, listen, I don't condone, you know, racism at all. Okay. No,
I shut that shit down. I don't think anybody does.
But this is a show with the Peacemaker's, you know, reality of kind of like why he is the way he is, and mm-hmm. his father's a dick and he's a racist and, you know, he gets what's coming to him and whatever, you know, it's a happy ending. You know what I mean? It's just the reality.
Well, look, Evan, you mentioned it. You mentioned Cobra Kai. They do the same thing there. Johnny is racist, but that self-awareness. They're like, this guy is clueless, and that's part of his character. And I think that's the same with Peacemaker here.
Mm-hmm. And Augie in the comics is that type of guy. He is that guy.
Yeah.
So they're going off of what they know.
I think my favorite part of this episode is when Peacemaker tries to escape the apartment and he just falls every single time. Like, smashes his shoulder. And then the couple was like, it's almost like they're like a weed smoking couple who they're like, they're fighting and screaming, you know, he's like, shut the hell, you know, when the cops come in, you know.
Evan, I have a question for you, because you've seen a little bit more than I have in a lot of these things. Has Dwayne Johnson, a.k.a. The Rock, has he ever gone this adult?
No.
No, he did a sci-fi movie years ago, and I forget the name, that was kind of like an avant-garde kind of thing that didn't
like
do anything.
Pain and Gain. Other than that, he did like Pain and Gain, something like
Pain
that.
Pain and Gain. Well, I would say Pain and Gain was Michael Bay's most serious attempt at like a dramatic comedy movie. And I think that's actually one of The Rock's best performances, because he's a convict that's just released from prison who's found religion, but he's also like a coke addict, and it's a pretty multi-layered performance. But after that, he went to Fast Five, where he got all buffed out again, and kind of went back to what sort of worked for him initially, which is sort of that wrestling audience, you know, big kind of deal.
Well, I guess the reason I ask is because we've never seen like a top WWE or even any wrestling star who goes so far, you know, into adult land. You know what I mean? I mean, WWE is basically a family-oriented product. So it's really interesting to see one of the face of it. He's still kind of the face of the company, being so over the top.
I'm going to be honest with you. This is just my, if I can put my opinion in real quick. I don't think, okay, just imagine John Cena, obviously as Peacemaker, okay, Christopher Smith, all right, perfect. I thought they casted him perfectly.
I agree.
Right? Imagine now The Rock as Peacemaker.
It'd be all about The Rock. We wouldn't even care. Like, the way they would film it, we wouldn't even care about the other characters.
Exactly.
Because The Rock would have to be in every frame of every scene.
Exactly. So I that's just my opinion, is that I don't think The Rock can pull off something like this. If he does, give it a try. But I just don't think with this type of, you know, the storyline and what James Gunn was trying, if he does go into that type of, you know, genre, maybe, but I don't see it.
Yeah. I mean, if you're talking about wrestlers and nuanced acting performances, I think you guys need to look up the Macho Man Slim Jim commercial. There was a very, very nuanced, very dramatic.
Terry Funkin' over the top.
yes. Episode 3, Better Goth Dead, written and directed by James Gunn. Mern briefs Smith on their first mission to assassinate U.S. Senator Roiland Goff, a suspected butterfly. Great, great stuff. Smith expresses hesitance to kill Goff's wife and children, who are also presumed butterflies, despite previously saying he would kill pretty much anyone for peace. Smith and Harcourt stake out the Goff household and are soon joined by a tag-along vigilante. When the Goff family are seen displaying alien-like behavior, those big tongues, and Mern orders Smith to assassinate him, but he hesitates. Vigilante takes over and successfully kills Goff's wife and children. But before he can kill Goff, the family's bodyguard, Judo Master, intervenes and incapacitates Smith and Vigilante. Once inside the house, Goff tries to force Smith to give up information by torturing Vigilante and unmasking him as Adrian Chase. They're interrupted by the group, Mern, Harcourt, and Adebayo, giving Smith the opportunity to free himself and kill Goff. While Economos incapacitates Judo Master, Smith and Vigilante witness a butterfly-like creature emerge from Goff's corpse. And the Argus computer, you get a wide shot showing that the butterflies are all over the world. Things start to pick up here a little bit. Guys, episode 3, Better Goff Dead.
Great episode.
I just love the titles. I love the titles of the episodes.
Right?
So they are great, aren't they? They are very good.
So great. Yeah, no, I loved the intro of Judo Master. I loved it, and I loved how the vigilante is just following the Peacemaker around now, you know, kind of became, I guess you could say in this episode, part of the group in a way, you know. I mean, it was pretty badass that he just kind of took that and just started sniping, you know.
Yeah.
So he's like, all right, leave. I got this.
Yeah, when the bodyguard, when Goff's bodyguard, like, the Hardcore Leota.
Like, stalls.
Yeah. It was great, yeah.
I think my favorite part of this episode, if I'm correct, I haven't seen it in a while, but I did see every episode, was Goff tortures Vigilante by trying to cut off his toe, but yet he can't successfully cut off the toe, but it's kind of mangled, and I think Smith is like, you're fine with four toes. You know, Peacemaker's toe. But I think you get a shot of the actual foot with the toe kind of hanging there, and I just remember laughing at that scene, you know, like,
it was great, because the whole time Vigilante's like, you can't walk right without your pinky toe. The pinky toe's the strongest, like, can't do it. That was a great scene.
Yeah, and then you got
also.
Go ahead.
No, I remember the ending too. That wide shot of the computer where you see all the butterflies.
Yes.
I felt like starts to pick up here a little bit more with the action.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you also have, like you said, Augie at the end is like, "Hail the White Dragon." You said you made reference to that, so obviously that's a little foreshadowing.
Well, let's go on to episode number 4, The Chode Less Traveled, written by Jody Hill and directed by James Gunn. So the group takes Judo Master back to their headquarters, where Smith claims he had killed the butterfly. Chase drives Smith to Augie's house to retrieve his new equipment, where Smith learns that Augie has been framed and arrested. Against Mern's wishes, and despite Adebayo trying to talk him down, Smith visits Augie in prison. Augie threatens to expose Project Butterfly to the police. Adebayo suggests to Chase that Smith would be better off without his father. Chase, a.k.a. Vigilante, gets himself arrested so he can kill Augie in prison. Smith and Adebayo return to the headquarters where an escaped Judo Master attacks Smith. Adebayo shoots Judo Master before he can reveal a secret about the butterflies. Smith returns to his trailer where he's keeping the butterfly creature alive in a jar and reflects on the fact in the prior movie he had to kill Rick Flag, as well as his traumatic childhood that includes the death of his brother. In prison, Vigilante provokes Augie's prison mates into fighting, but fails to get Augie involved. He is later bailed out by Hardcourt. Adebayo finds a lead on the butterflies and informs Mern, who is secretly a butterfly himself. A lot of stuff going on here. Guys, episode 4, The Chode Less Traveled.
Every time you say it, it just makes me laugh.
The Chode Less Traveled.
Well, I only have really one thing to say
the
about
chode,
this one.
Less Traveled.
The one thing that stands out for me in this episode, and you understand, and Evan will understand why. Yeah, there's a lot going on, and it's all great. But my favorite part is the Vigilante's little rant about black people and rock and roll.
Oh my God,
that had me. Like black people are responsible for Lynyrd Skynyrd. And I'm sitting there like this. Like, all right, now, like. If I knew what James Gunn was then, I'm thinking about it. Now James Gunn is saying, all right, all bets are off, you know, and I think I like rewound it like a few times just to get the whole gist of it. That just had me laughing like for the rest of the episode. So I wasn't really as focused as I could have been because I was enjoying it too much. I was enjoying the visuals and all that stuff, but that just, it just still makes me laugh, just because it's so well written. It's not gratuitous. So, yeah, I loved it.
Moni, what'd you think of episode 4?
So, I actually really loved this episode because it kind of dived into, you know, Peacemaker finding out that, you know, John put his father as the scapegoat to be arrested. And that whole scene between Ekamos and Peacemaker was just so, the dialogue between them two was so freaking hilarious. That scene right there actually made me laugh, you know, throughout the whole episode, because I'm just like, oh my God, these two are literally battling out with insults and words. Like, it's just, it was incredible. You know, of course, with Peacemaker giving him the nickname Dyebeard, and he doesn't call him John, doesn't call him Econos. It's just Dyebeard. You know?
Oh yeah, that's the guy who keeps saying, like, I don't dye my beard. It's a weird color.
Yeah, I don't dye my beard. It's just weird colored, okay? Like,
you know, just, you're eating, episode, you're eating 4-year-old almonds or whatever he was eating, you know?
Yes, yes. And then the whole conversation between him and Leota about the Berenstain Bears, that was great too.
Yeah.
And it's like he sends her a picture of the cover. He's like, that looks Photoshopped. You Photoshopped that. It's the Berenstain Bears. And that whole dialogue, there was just such amazing dialogue in this episode. I loved it. And also the plot twist at the end with, you know, Leota finding out that Mern is a butterfly. That was great. And to end the episode like that was just, it was incredible. I thought, it's like, ooh, what's going to happen? Like, oh my God, is he going to kill her? I thought that was great. The episode was great.
Well, that's the next episode, but you get the reveal that Mern is a butterfly. But for me, the biggest takeaway was the backstory of Peacemaker.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
that you see he kills his brother completely mm-hmm. by accident. He's forced into this almost like a racist barbecue where they're betting on the two brothers.
They're
betting on the brothers fighting, and you could see the acting is so good by these kids because they're almost like fun. This is all they know.
Right.
And so the brother, you know, Christopher Smith, the brother is hi Elliot. It's Elliot. But
he watched Peacemaker with me, so she knows a little bit too.
All right, Elliot, we'll get your comments as well.
Under 17, not allowed unless accompanied by a parent or guardian. So, perfectly okay.
Well, I did think that whole reveal for a show that's pretty comedic gives it a real serious sort of undertone mm-hmm. of the Peacemaker character.
Yeah.
I thought that was my biggest takeaway from the episode.
And both of you, you know, reminded me that, like, they keep throwing things at us that surprise us. Like, we don't see much of this coming. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Especially someone like me who's new to this universe. You know, usually someone like me, I've seen a million movies. I could spot plot twists coming around, you know, every corner.
Right.
Not here. I don't see any. It's all surprising to me, and that's what keeps people coming back.
Yeah, the Augie character.
That was great.
And the Augie character too. I mean, Smith kills his brother, and Augie he's put his son into this situation, and there's not one piece where you could kind of latch in on the character to like. He blames the son, and he does like a religious thing, or he's like, you know, Christ will strike you down. You know, and he hates his kid now for a situation that he put his own son into.
Well, Robert Patrick
and it was a built up.
Yeah, and he just, I mean, he's so great here. He chews up the scenery in the best way possible, mm-hmm. which is what I love. But I have a question for both of you about Suicide Squad. When did Peacemaker show up? In those movies, where was he in the second one?
Right at the beginning.
At the beginning of when was
the second movie? He was in the second movie.
Okay,
he was in the Suicide Squad.
Because the reason that I ask is because I have to think all of Hollywood must have wanted to play this part. It's so juicy. Oh. It's so good. Like, how could somebody turn this kind of part down? So I wonder. I wonder if Cena was their first go-to. I'd be interested to find that out.
So I'll take a stab at that because I think if you listen to the comments that James Gunn said, some of the research, mm-hmm. he has a real appreciation for Cena as an actor. And again, I don't know if he's familiar with his wrestling stuff. I'm sure he is to some level. John Cena was a major star in the WWE. I think Cena, in terms of an actor, and I want to move on to the other episodes, but I think Cena did it smart. Mm-hmm. He did the Marine, didn't do anything. It made a few bucks, and you know it wasn't very well reviewed. But he did a couple of small cameo type roles in good films, and he got good reviews there. And kind of built himself up slowly,
like Trainwreck.
So I think he's done it well in terms his acting choices. You mentioned The Rock. I think Cena's been a little bit more, at least early on, he's been a little more selective. Mm-hmm. There's been one or two small dogs. He did a stupid fireman's movie, like a kid's movie that was really, I forget the name, it was silly. But most of the stuff he's done has been pretty good.
Yeah, The Rock basically went right to headline.
Yeah.
You know?
Right.
So
bigger. More
he didn't really. Yeah, he really didn't get to hone his craft that much before he was carrying movies on his shoulders. Cena obviously has taken a more methodical approach, like Evan said, and it's paying off big time. Like I would rather, and I know I'm going off on a rant, but like when I see The Rock doing these kinds of movies, when I see The Rock in Jungle Cruise, I'm like, just fucking come back to WWE. All right, enough of this stuff. With Cena, if you ask me, would I rather Cena be at WrestleMania or be too busy filming Peacemaker Season 2? My answer would be I'd rather him be filming Peacemaker Season 2 because that's where he belongs right now. I don't feel that way about The Rock.
Once again, Andrew's wrong. I would say both. make your pick.
All right. If both is on the table, then of course. But, you know, I see him as, I don't know, all right, I don't want to give my final thoughts on the thing until the end, so let's continue.
Please, we have a three-hour time limit. I got Marie's coming home soon.
So,
episode number 5, Monkey Dory, written by Rosemary Rodriguez, directed by James Gunn. At Augie's urging, Song and Fitzgibbons realize that Smith killed Sturfhausen after double-checking Augie's fingerprints and re-interrogating the couple that Smith held hostage. This team is briefed about how butterflies enter human hosts and feed only on an unknown amber fluid, which will come into play later in the series. Adebayo's clue leads them to a nearby bottling factory where the liquid is processed and bottled. While Mern enlists an associate, Casper Locke, to pose as the new police captain and undermine Song's investigation. Song resorts to requesting help from her uncle, a judge. Smith uses a helmet with X-ray vision to learn that all of the factory employees are butterflies, as well as an escaped gorilla named Charlie. They kill the employees, and Economos earns Smith's respect by killing Charlie with a chainsaw. The team bond on the way back from the factory, and Smith invites Adebayo to drink at his home, where she advises him to be nicer to others. She secretly plants a diary in his home as ordered by her mom, Amanda Waller. Returning to the office, Adebayo discovers Smith's X-ray helmet. Then we get the reveal that Adebayo realizes that Mern is a butterfly, and the episode ends with her falling to the floor and Mern about to attack her. Guys, episode number 5, Monkey Dory!
Monkey Dory.
Go ahead.
It was a great episode.
Yeah, great ending. Great ending.
Great ending. Again, the storyline never broke off. By this point, usually sometimes with shows, especially in this type of genre, tend to kind of veer off into something else, in my opinion, and you kind of get lost. With this show, by this time, I was like, dude, this is incredible. Everyone is kind of like, you know, participating. The factory bus was great. I thought that was hilarious. Yeah. You know, Vigilante wanted to kill somebody with the chainsaw. Wasn't able to, and here comes Diebeard out of nowhere, and there's Vigilante with the dialogue of, yeah, you know what else would have been cool? If John would have gave me the chainsaw, and I would have done it, and then I'm like, hey! You know, like, we all did it! That was great. Yeah, still, you know, serious, but the comedy was spot on.
What do you think, Rue, for the episode?
This episode was kind of a turning point because now, like, the stakes are rising and you can feel it. Because you know it's like, you know it's 8 episodes, so this is, I think, 5. And this is where you start seeing it sort of heading to that end game kind of thing. No pun intended. That said, with some of the smaller moments, like, I love the chemistry between Leota and Peacemaker where she's kind of telling him to drop the nonsense. I kind of like that. At this point, it's on. I don't want, like, I'm saying autopilot, even, but I don't mean that in a negative way. I mean, like, this show is so confident in what it is that it's almost like I could picture them in the writer's room and being like, yeah, put it in. You know, like, nothing is off the table. And that, to me, is very courageous and adventurous writing. I love that little part towards the beginning when he's, like, telling them all the different people he could have blamed this whole thing on. You know, like, just this episode, the show is so consistent, it's sort of hard to break them down at this point because everything is kind of moving.
Perfectly.
Exactly. So, you know, like, without, like, I can't be critical. Like, sometimes it helps to have things to criticize, and there's just, right now, there's nothing, you know? It's just all fun, and the biggest thing is it's all making sense. Like, I get it. What's going on. I had to watch Avengers Infinity War and Endgame, like, 3 times each to finally figure out everything, you know? And I'm not doing that here. So this is an excellent episode. Actually, I would, with the exception of episode 3, I think this is my favorite one so far.
Yeah, for sure.
Episode 6, Mern After Reading, written and directed by James Gunn. Mern reveals to Adebayo that the butterflies came from a dying planet, and the Goth butterfly led the others in a plan to dominate Earth, with the Mern butterfly being the sole dissenter. To Locke's dismay, Song releases Augie from prison and acquires an arrest warrant for Christopher Smith. At Smith's trailer, the Goth butterfly attempts to communicate with Smith and Chase, but the Evergreen police force arrive to arrest Smith. Chase accidentally breaks the butterfly's jar, allowing it to take over Song. Smith, Chase, and Eagly escape with Locke's help, while the latter acquires the fake diary. Economos traces the butterfly's activity to Coverdale Ranch, where he believes that the butterflies are using a cow creature to mass-produce the amber fluid. Adebayo feels guilty about hiding secrets from Christopher Smith. Butterfly Song, she's now taken over, summons a butterfly army and takes over the Evergreen police force, prisoners, and Locke. Augie prepares his followers and puts on the white dragon armor, intending to kill his son. Butterfly Locke uses the fake diary to publicly incriminate Smith and issue an arrest warrant. Guys, episode 6, Mern After Reading. I'm going to take it initially because, Matt, this is where you, like, when you see a television series similar, even with Marvel, the one thing I'm always disappointed about is it. While TV, like James Gunn talks about, TV allows maybe some you could take more chances with the plot and things of that nature. Sometimes it doesn't feel like you want that movie experience with TV.
Right.
You know, I would say, I'll give you my final thoughts. If there was maybe some criticism, like Peacemaker, you don't get a lot of special effects. But here, when that butterfly army takes over the police force, that was a really super cool scene where all the butterflies attack. I thought that was super cool. And of course, I think the other thing that stands out to me was I just love the scene. I think, isn't this where they hide in the tree while the police
yes,
horses,
they had to yeah, kind of get away
and they get all this
tree.
Like great banter, and they're looking for Eagly yeah. to help yep. out, and I think Eagly flies away. So, yeah. So all right, I'll take a break here. What'd you guys think? Episode 6, Mern After Reading.
Mony?
Girl.
Okay.
How about this? What did you think of the Mern butterfly reveal? Like, he's a good guy. He's the good butterfly.
Well. He's the I don't know if good butterfly, but
he's a dissenter.
Yeah, he's the one who's kind of ambiguous. You know, he's like is he becoming like this one's version of Thanos a little bit? Probably not, but that's what I love. I love ambiguity. I love that these characters are not just black and white. You could say the same thing actually from my point of view about Augie. You know, like, Augie's got every reason to feel the way he feels, yet he's still a scumbag, you know, and I...
Whoa, hold on. He has every reason to feel what?
No, I mean, he's a bad guy.
Yes.
But who has... how do I say it? He's not... Alright, I came out wrong. Like, he comes from bad stuff. You know, like
well, you don't know that. Hold on. Because I'll take a little umbrage with that. Because
okay.
I said earlier on, there's nothing sympathetic written about this character. Whereas maybe in other movies, you might get something where you get that little glimmer of hope. Here, you don't know Augie's background. You know Christopher Smith's background as a child of Augie. But Augie's written up as a straight-up scumbag. And there's nothing that he wants to kill his son. There's nothing there that, as a viewer, to me, that makes you go... Oh, maybe there's a sliver of hope for him. He's just a bad guy.
But what I'm telling you, and this will sound like very snobbish, but what I meant by it is that the performance of Robert Patrick is showing me little grimaces of conflict since the beginning. Maybe it's just maybe I'm looking too
really?
Much. Yeah, just the way he's doing it, like. You could see maybe it's just he reminds me of his character. Maybe he's reminding me of his character from The Sopranos. I don't know, but it's the way he's attacking this performance that to me there's got to be more there. There's got to be more than just what they're showing us. That's what I mean by that. I mean that I mean there's, you know, does that make any sense?
No, I disagree with you on that one.
Okay.
I mean,
but do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, but
okay, you can disagree.
The characters. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No. I'm saying it's perfect to disagree. I just want to make sure you understand why I'm my point.
I enjoy Robert Patrick's performance. What I'm saying to you is the Augie character. I don't see any element of conflict. I don't see any element of niceness. Straight off the bat, he's a cantankerous guy. He's not nice. You know, we have the racism angle, the white dragon angle, but there's no point in the movie where he contemplates feeling bad or he, you know, even talks about the love of his child. He hates his kid. He wants to kill him. And he's not a nice guy. Usually in movies, there's some sort of, seeing the light and changes somebody over. I don't get any glimmer of that in Peacemaker. Yeah. Augie Smith, the dad, is a bad guy, and that's how he's straight up written.
Yeah, you know what? I guess it's hard to get past that whole "I want to kill my kid" thing. Yeah, you're right. The guy is just such a good actor, I guess.
Yeah,
Moni, what are your thoughts?
No, there's no empathy from Augie.
Right, that's
there's
true.
There's no empathy. He doesn't feel bad for anything that he did to his son. He doesn't care. He thinks that his son became the biggest coward pussy on the planet. He's told that to him, to his face. You know, like, you just became this, you know, the kind of a disappointment. And he hates that. He has no ounce of love for his son. So, sorry. Oh, my gosh. Fuck in my throat. I think that's where, you know, Evan was kind of getting at. Like, there's no character switch of his characteristic. He literally has that much hate in him just as a person. Not just, you know, yes, he has that hate towards his son, but also to, like, almost everyone else in a way that's not following him, you know, and that's sad. It's kind of sad, but you know what? It's who he is. That's how they wrote his character. That's how he's supposed to be.
Yeah, I think you've convinced me. There's that whole Fight Club thing. But
right.
You know, if I was to pick a debate team, Andrew Guthrie would be my number one pick. He'd be like, "Yeah, you're right. I'll just sit down."
Well, because I also listen.
And now for rebuttal, Carl Springs Charter.
Hey,
you're right. You're right. Thank you. You're right.
Yeah, you convinced me. I'm good.
You convinced me. It's a crazy.
I'd be a great defense lawyer, wouldn't I? Yeah, no questions. I'm good.
You're right, prosecutor. We'll take the 30-year to life sentence. Thank you. Episode 7: Stop Dragging My Heart Around. Written by Brad Anderson. Directed by James Gunn. Smith sets to find out. To find the cow with Chase, Eagly, and a reluctant Economos, but they are intercepted by Augie and his followers. Harcourt confronts Adebayo on her secret mission and betrayal, learning of her relationship to Amanda Waller in the process. Myrne attempts to leave with them, but the butterfly-possessed police arrive and kill him. Harcourt and Adebayo ponder their next step. Judo Master attacks them. He is ultimately tased and rendered unconscious by Adebayo. After a lengthy chase, Smith is caught by Augie and his followers. Eagly attempts to save him, but is injured by Augie. Chase hits a weak point in Augie's armor, disabling his weapons, while Economos kills Augie's followers. Smith confronts Augie about his actions that led to Smith accidentally killing his brother when they were children, before killing Augie. Shoots him right there, squared in, right in the head. The team reunites in a nearby veterinary clinic where Eagly recovers. Without Myrne, the team appoints Harcourt as their new leader, who then briefs them on the butterfly's attempt to teleport the cow to another enclave. The team heads off to kill the cow, and Adebayo tries to apologize to Smith, but he tells her that their friendship is over. Guys, episode 7, stop dragging my heart around. Let me ask you right off the bat. I have some additional notes on this episode. Were you guys shocked at all, you know, in terms of the Augie death? Peacemaker shoots his dad square in the head.
Yes.
Right in the noggin. Any thoughts on that whole sort of ending of that sort of subplot?
Well, yes.
No.
I was, because I didn't think that they would do away with such an effective subplot. so early in the show's run, even though this is the, I think, the second to last episode of the first season, at the same time, you know, the whole universe, multiple universe thing, he might not be dead at all. So you never really know anymore. But it was a very emotional scene, I have to say that. I did love Vigilante, what Vigilante said there, like to sort of break the tension. I didn't see it coming, but I thought it was very good. Like I said, it was surprising to me. Well, Mony, why weren't you surprised?
Well, with Peacemaker's kind of going in his traumatic past, having that kind of relived again, if you think about it, I think he was just kind of gave up on giving his dad another chance.
Yeah.
He was just like, nah, you ruined my life, man. You gotta die. You know, like I, cause you know how I said that Augie has no empathy for Smith, you know, for Peace.
And yeah.
I think he understood that. He's like, you really don't like me, man. Like, I'm your son. Why don't you like me? You know, I don't care about love, but just, you know, come, you know, stand, just like me. I think he realized that. I think that's why the shot to the head was just, when I saw that scene, I straight up was like, thank God. You know, like, yes.
Well, I was like, no, give the guy another chance. He's only misunderstood.
Yeah. No, I think he gave his dad so many chances that he was just like, this is it. You're trying to kill me.
Yeah.
You know, you're not trying to do anything else. You're trying to kill me. So, no.
It's like it's like the Sopranos. It's like the Sopranos when his mom was trying to have him killed. It's the same idea.
Right, and you know, for that was for me, you know, but with the episode itself, I loved the development for Vigilante myself, because, you know, at that point, you know, you see the Vigilante in the last couple episodes, you know, kind of being a part, whatever, but you kind of see him blossom a little bit in this episode. Which I love, because it's like, I hope this guy sticks around. I hope, you know, I actually love his character. He was great. And the development for him was awesome. And, you know, just kind of having that and you know, getting, you know, through the forest and everything. I thought it was great. It was a great episode to me. I thought, again, the writing was phenomenal. The dialogue between everybody. It was a good setup for the finale, I thought, in my opinion. Great setup.
And it was shorter. It seemed a little tighter, too.
Hold on. So ultimately, the death of Augie, you have to remember, Peacemaker character kills for peace. And he sort of becomes disconnected early in the season.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
He refuses to kill children and a woman. I think ultimately that scene, he realizes he kind of came from hatred.
Right. But
ultimately, that's what he is. And so his dad's got to go. I think that's Christopher Smith realizes, I'm a killer. Maybe I might be a nice killer. This is what I come from. And I'm going to take him out. Were you guys surprised at the Mern death at all? I mean,
I was a little bit kind of like, oh, no,
you get two characters here in this episode that get killed.
Right. Because, you know, I was just upset because I kind of was getting, you know, used to Mern being who he was and, you know, loved him as a character, but it was sad. I was like, oh no, not Mern. But that, you know.
Well, this episode is perfectly titled. What is it? Stop dragging my heart around. Like they go in a lot. They go from laughs to like pulling the heartstrings a little bit. Like they touch all the bases in this one. And I think, so far, this has been my favorite episode, episode 7.
Yeah, no, it's so many character developments in this episode. Like I said, such a great setup for the finale.
Yeah.
Well, I think they did a good job. I love how they pick Harcourt to be the new leader.
Yep.
I think I wasn't surprised. I think Harcourt was next in line. And I kind of was touched a little bit with the whole Eagly injury that they... You could see where John Cena, the Peacemaker, was concerned that his little buddy might not make it.
Yeah,
and I love the reaction from Leota. Like, she calls Kia and it's like, I just saw an eagle hug a human. Like, just like, you know, so like that that part was so good because it was just so random. You know, there's so many random points in this like show that were just so spot on. Like it fit, even though it didn't make sense, it fit.
What about the ending where you get the reveal of the cow, which is, I guess, in a way the master villain? You know, that you're going to see in episode 8, but that's where I was like, finally, like that. Yeah. There's your DC Comics splashy CGI, yeah, and you know, crazy villain.
And it's also like this is what our final thing is going to be this year,
right?
Like you said, it just literally tease it up to just hit it in the next episode. Right.
Well, it looked like a giant baby. Damn, you guys think that it looked like a giant?
No, but it had the James Gunn feel because you had the starfish. Exactly. You had the starfish in the Suicide Squad.
Yeah.
So it was like
it looks like a giant baby.
It's a big giant kaiju. You know what I mean?
Like kaiju.
Yeah.
Yes, when Dark Beard was like, no kaijus.
So we wrap it up, guys, with episode 8. It's Cow or Never, written and directed by James Gunn. Adebayo contacts her mom, requesting backup, but the team initiates their plan due to a lack of time. Economos plants Smith's sonic boom helmet at the butterfly's base, but fails to kill the cow. Smith, Harcourt, and Chase begin an assault. Many of the butterflies are killed, but Harcourt and Chase are shot. Adebayo saves Harcourt by killing more butterflies. Christopher Smith battles Butterfly Song, who spares him and asks for his assistance, explaining that the butterflies are protecting the planet from humans. Oh, boy. I love these. Humans are the enemy.
Right.
who prioritize profit over their own survival. Smith responds by killing the cow by launching Adebayo into it using his human torpedo helmet. Smith kills Butterfly Locke and destroys Song's body, but spares the goth butterfly. The Justice League make an appearance, but they arrive too late to help. Harcourt and Chase undergo medical treatment, and Smith and Adebayo make amends. Adebayo exposes Project Butterfly, Task Force X, and Amanda Waller's her mom's role to the press, clearing Christopher Smith's name. Economos returns to work at the Bell Rev Penitentiary. Adrian Chase escapes from the hospital. Harcourt continues her recovery, and Smith returns home with Eagly and the Goth Butterfly. But at the end, you see that he is haunted by hallucinations of his dad, Augie. Guys, episode 8, it's Cow or Never. Season 1 wraps up Peacemaker. What do you guys think of the finale?
Oh, great. Like I said, the whole development of each character came through in this episode, for sure. Like I said, with the setup, you know, from episode 7 to this, was well executed, in my opinion, in regards to kind of tying in, you know, yes, the Justice League. I thought that whole dialogue was just freaking hilarious.
That was great.
I was like, first of all, they actually had Ezra Miller and Jason Momoa there. Yes. I was like, oh my, did I just see my, what? Like, you know, just freaking out a little bit. But it didn't really excite, like, but didn't excite me as much as, you know, watching the show. Yes, they put the Justice League in there, but it was just kind of like a, you know, screw you. You guys are a little late, dickheads. Like, you know, hello, we already killed all of them. But we didn't discuss this, though, Evan. Judo Master coming back. Because remember, he escaped when Vigilante and Peacemaker were leaving to go kill, you know, go find the farm.
Yes.
Did we discuss? Yeah. So he escaped. You know, we kind of got Judo Master to, you know, kind of be. So where's this character going? It kind of like opened up such a awesome way to probably season 2, you know, for that writing. And I just, it was just so action packed. I loved it how they used Economos, you know, to go in to pretend to be, you know, a butterfly. And it was just so well executed. I loved Leota, the way she was used to, and just everything. Of course, you know, with the, oh my God, is Harcourt dying? Like, you know, like, is she dying? It was great. The suspense the whole way through of, like, what's going to happen. You know, I love what the Yoda said when they were in the hospital. And she said it to Peacemaker of, we have to make our own choices. You know, we have to learn from our choices. I don't like being, you know, basically being told what to do. So I thought that was great. That was a good, you know, line from her. I love that line. But yeah, that's it. I loved it.
Grill, what'd you think of the finale?
Yeah, this was fantastic. Number one, it shows us, you know, we finally know more about the butterflies, and mm-hmm. what their whole you know, purpose is. And that ties that up nicely while still keeping us in sort of suspense. I love how they basically, like you said, the Justice League is there, but it's like, screw you. Where you been? We don't need you. That's almost like James Gunn saying, you know, we got this. You guys can run your little four-hour Zack Snyder things. We can, we've got our own little thing going here, but thanks anyway. And I really like that. That's what, you know, to help these things stand on their own, you don't need to stand on the shoulders of what came before if you do it right. And that's what they're, you know, and this episode actually, you know, number one, any episode of this, of any show that has as many fart jokes as this one, I'm all in. So I was like, and cause it's funny how like we're going into this, maelstrom of what we know is going to be like a big, you know, a big meltdown, and yet we are, you know, Evan and I, anytime we hear any kind of fart, we just laugh. So it's just part of our thing. But this is all John Cena, man. Like with the right. way when I walked away from this episode and thus the first season, I'm like, John Cena has found his.
Niche.
His Terminator, his, you know, I think this is the guy he will be coming back to 20 years from now. You know, like I feel like it's so spot on and so and such a perfect match of performer and character, and that's really what this episode kind of, you know, kind of made me think. Like I was really. Is it weird, Evan, is it weird for me to say that I'm proud of John Cena?
No.
Like, do you know, like let it's, me, yeah, go ahead.
Let me take it from here. First of all, with the fart jokes, I do want to wish a happy 35th birthday to Robin Snockers. Okay, that's an inside Howard Stern joke. From the
we had it at the beginning of the show.
Yeah. It, just on episode 8, a couple of things. I love Adebayo as the final weapon that's projected into the cow that kills the cow. Of course, the Justice League cameo is great. You also get a little tease of perhaps a Smith Harcourt romance. You get a little tease, you know, at the end of the episode. And of course, it kind of ends on a little bit of a serious note because you see that Christopher Smith is perhaps. Traumatized, you know, and still has hallucinations of his father. So again, like, you know, Andrew, like you mentioned the multiverse, but perhaps there's a way to continue the Augie character into season two. In terms of John Cena, I've said this even prior. I think he has the highest ceiling in terms of a wrestler, but I think ultimately his hope and my hope is at some point we just move away from the wrestling conversation.
Right.
And obviously look at him as just a pure actor, which I think he'll be able to do. I think his, you know, like you said, his work ethic and throwing himself into, you know, like even his promotion on all the talk shows, he wore the Peacemaker helmet. He's into it. He's super into it.
Well,
and
that's...
I think that's...
It's interesting you say that because that comes from the wrestling background. I think you live your gimmick, you know.
I agree.
And you know, like in when you compare him to like The Rock, when The Rock is on screen, his name is Dwayne Johnson. When he's in the ring, his name is The Rock. John Cena is John Cena regardless of where he is. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's why I kind of look at Cena with a little more. Respect as far as the acting talent and what he's willing to do, whether it's sharing the screen with others or, you know, playing second fiddle sometimes. Like, he's not the head focus of every single moment of this thing. And that's, you know, John's one thing that everybody says about John Cena that we've heard since we've, you know, because we've been fans, he doesn't seem to have much of an ego. You know what I mean?
No, he's very humble. I've noticed that. He's very humble. He's very, like, you know, just, this is who I am. I'm going to, you know, do what I have to do. And, yeah, I agree with that.
Yeah.
He's very, like, kind of.
And that translates.
I'm going to take it from here. Number one, let's stop comparing him to The Rock. Number two, you know, yes, I think publicly John Cena is a humble guy. But you absolutely know that to be on top of the WWE for 12, 13 years, to be at the top of the card, that was work ethic. But you know all those guys play backstage politics, and you've seen other wrestlers come out and talk about that John Cena put the kibosh on this. And you know what?
Right.
That's what makes the top guys great. So, you know, I'm sure John Cena has been accused of playing backstage politics and keeping himself at the top of the card. Let's get to the reception of season one. Peacemaker, the review aggregator website Rotten Tomatoes, reported a 95% approval rating, which is an average rating of 7.7 out of 10 based on 73 reviews. The website's critical consensus reads, John Cena still in solid form as Peacemaker, leading a bloody good time that gives writer-director James Gunn full permission to let his freak flag fly. Metacritic gave it a weighted score of 69 out of 100 based on reviews from 24 critics, indicating generally favorable reviews. IGN gave the first three episodes 8 out of 10, saying that the three-episode premiere offers a goofy takedown of vigilantism while praising the cast performance. The Guardian gave the first three episodes a score of 3 out of 5, writing James Gunn's Suicide Squad character gets his own HBO Max series with mixed results, but a winning central performance. RollingStone.com gave Peacemaker 3 out of 4, saying Peacemaker declares war on self-serious superheroes. Writer-director James Gunn's take on the bucket-headed hero is a gloriously goofy send-up and a sincere character study rolled into one. It's not a surprise that Cena is a gifted comedic actor, more versatile in game than Dwayne Johnson, even if The Rock's magnetism is undeniable. And Gunn leans on his star's verbal gifts as much as his physical ones. We'll go to Andrew Gruthius first. Grew on a scale of 0 to 4 Peacemakers. What is your review of Peacemaker season one and your overall thoughts?
Easy. 4 out of 4, because this is a prime example of everything that these things should be. Fearless, trusting in their vision, trusting in their actors, trusting in their writers and directors. You're keeping politics out of it, and it's straight entertainment, storytelling, acting, directing, writing, music. It all fits. It all works. And since we have to compare it, I mean, we just can't not compare it to the Marvel stuff. All right? So I've seen a couple of the Marvel TV shows. I've seen WandaVision. I've seen a few episodes of Hawkeye and one of the other ones. And I got to tell you, Peacemaker blows them all away. Okay? As far as the TV side of their universe, this is the high watermark of these universe TV shows, including Star Wars, and I love The Mandalorian. This is better than that. So these guys have done an absolute knockout job. I give it 4 out of 4. I can't wait to see the next season. I'm so happy that they're continuing with it. 4 out of 4. I was glued and I was laughing and I was like the whole time. There was never a lull. So, yeah, 4 out of 4.
All right. Well, I'll take it from here. We'll let Mony have the final review. What did I like about season one of Peacemaker? John Cena. His performance, great cast. I love the backstory of Peacemaker. It's serious, it's fun. What did I dislike about it? I mean, Butterflies is a villain, but a little slow out of the gate. I will give it 3.5 Peacemaker helmets. Cena is a major star, and the series is just campy enough to have you laugh, but take it seriously along the way. Could I make a case for 4? I don't disagree with anything Gru said. And I, to be honest with you, I agree with him in terms of the television projects. I won't compare it to Star Wars, but I will compare it to MCU. I did enjoy Peacemaker the most. Maybe I'm shaded a little bit about my love for John Cena as a wrestling fan. However, comparative to WandaVision and the other, you know, Loki and the other stuff, I've enjoyed those. But yeah, I think Peacemaker was what kept my interest, and I look forward to the most. I'll give it 3.5 Peacemaker helmets. Mony, what's your review of season one, Peacemaker?
I'm going to actually have to do 4 out of 4 on this one, and this is why.
All right.
The writing was impeccable. The character development was absolute genius. The storyline just fit perfectly with everybody and everyone in the show. The comedy, dry humor was absolutely incredible. And also the reality of the show, the real world type of stuff.
Yes,
you know, that we go through is it was amazing to see. It was amazing to kind of be like, oh, and I go through that too. You know, we're on the same page. And also with James Gunn doing such a great job of taking a superhero that's actually a comic superhero written as a Peacemaker and turning it into this was absolutely incredible. I loved everything about this. Like I said, the villain, yes, I get what you're saying, Evan, but it fit. You know, it fit perfectly to what, you know, the villains that they're fighting. You know, it's kind of, it becomes, you know, the stronger point of it. But yeah, I definitely give it 4 out of 4. Loved everything about it. I cannot wait, you know, for season 2 and seeing what they do with the rest of the characters and who they add in.
Rumor is for season 2 that they are fighting mosquitoes.
Love it. See, mosquitoes,
ladybugs,
are an endangered species.
I'm joking.
I'd like to add one thing on to what Mona said.
All right, listen, Andy, I'm on a hard 180.
I know, I'm almost.
No, I'm joking. I know.
From Ryan last week. Yeah. you said something very interesting there. When I'm watching the DC movies, you know, like Batman vs. Superman and all of them, and when I'm watching the Marvel movies as well, you never get the sense that you're on Earth. You get the sense that you're in this weird, you know, weird universe, even though you're supposed to be on Earth. Here, this could be happening in the apartment next door. Like, it felt closer to, you said, reality, and that's what I love. That's what I miss about superhero stories, where they were about extraordinary people in an ordinary world. And that's what this kind of brings it back to. There's a show that DC also does on the CW. It's completely different from this one, but it's the same. I like it for the same reason. It's called Superman and Lois.
Stop shilling for Superman and Lois.
I'm just saying. They do it the same. They do the same thing. You feel you are existing. You feel you exist in the same realm as these people, and that's what the Peacemaker does, and that's part of the reason why I love it so much.
Ordinary person, extraordinary world, gratuitous.
I'm gonna put that on a sign. Super.
I'm an extraordinary person in an ordinary world.
We should do a trailer.
An ordinary person in an extraordinary world.
Well, anyway. So you guys talked about
the Butterflies.
Peacemaker season 2. That's been confirmed. HBO has confirmed that they're renewing the show for a second season on HBO Max. John Cena is confirmed return to play the title character as the DC Comics anti-hero. And of course, the best news is that series creator and director James Gunn will also be back. The selected press release touts that Peacemaker has been the number one new original streaming series for social engagement on Twitter across all of television and the number one social show across Max Originals on multiple social platforms. I don't know what that means, but I guess that makes the TV show a hit in the streaming era. Here was James Gunn's comments on the news that Peacemaker will return for season 2. Quote, creating Peacemaker has been one of the true highlights of my life, both professionally and otherwise, with John Cena and the incredible creative team around me, as well as our wonderful partners at HBO Max, to have something we all love so much be loved by the audience in turn has been a wonderful experience. I can't wait for the folks to see where Team Peacemaker goes in season 2. Guys, I'm sure you are, but I'll ask anyway. Excited for season 2 of Peacemaker?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, hell yeah.
Oh, hell yeah.
That's a hell yeah.
Well, even just as, you know, you mentioned about Cena, you'd rather him be for season two of Peacemaker. I do want to add, as a wrestling fan, he wrestled a hell of a match against Roman Reigns at SummerSlam.
Yeah, he did.
The guy has been out of the ring. He did a good job. All right, Gru, you want to get to the week that was?
Let's do it. I got it. Ready to go.
All right. Gru, here we go. It's five things we're talking about this week. It's nothing worthwhile. The week that was. Gee, thanks. Such a vibe. Hey,
no, I did. I did it.
Go ahead, you bastard. Gru and Mony, nothing worthwhile. The week that was is brought to you by New Life Center. New Life Center is growing. Check them out in Phoenix at 4515 North 16th Street, Suite 105. That's Phoenix, Arizona, 85016. And you know what? I got to change the tagline. It was the same. The wonderful laser treatments restore your youthfulness with confidence.
Wait! They're paying us good money for you. Got to do it.
Well, Marie's going to do it. We're going to tape an opener for Marie at the beginning of the show.
Oh, okay.
That's Moni's mom.
Yeah,
my girlfriend. So, all right, guys. We're going back 2 weeks, but let's talk about a couple of things. The Super Bowl halftime show promised to be one of the biggest yet. Did they deliver? The West Coast was well represented as Snoop Dogg, Dr. Dre headlined a lineup that also featured Eminem, 50 Cent, Mary J. Blige, and Kendrick Lamar. The NFL immediately posted that the entire halftime show to their YouTube page in less than 24 hours, that the video had received over 18 million views. It also was in the number one trending spot via YouTube. Fans went crazy as Dr. Dre brought Snoop Dogg to the stage to open up with the next episode. Dre then launched into his iconic hit, California Love, as an homage to his hometown and his late friend Tupac Shakur. 50 Cent made a surprise appearance and performed in the club. Mary J. Blige rocked the SoFi Stadium crowd with her captivating performance of Family Affair and No More Drama before handing it over to another megastar. Kendrick Lamar followed up with Mad City and All Right before Eminem busted out his Academy Award-winning Lose Yourself. The spectacle wrapped up with Snoop and Dre performing Still Dre. The entire show was a cavalcade of hit music, flashy visuals, and major star power. NFL fans have responded with huge numbers. The video should easily surpass 20 million views by the end of Monday. It was a testament to the popularity of the performers, the NFL, and the Slick Show that kept fans interested. I myself, I'm a huge Mary J. Blige fan, and though not a big hip-hop head, I did recognize that Dr. Dre's The Chronic is perhaps one of the greatest hip-hop albums of all time. Guys, did the NFL hit it out of the park with this year's Super Bowl halftime show?
No. It's good. I thought that, I'm not a huge fan of that kind of music like you are, but there was nothing I didn't.
I just said, I'm not a huge hip-hop head, but I recognize The Chronic as being one of the greatest.
Yeah,
hip-hop albums of all time.
And I recognize that Lose Yourself is one of the best hip-hop songs ever, and that Snoop Dogg and Dr. Dre, you can't deny that these guys are the best at what they do. I thought the theatrics was a bit much. I kind of prefer the halftime shows where, like Tom Petty or Prince or even Springsteen, where they come out and they just play. Instead of like it looked like a big dollhouse, it was kind of overproduced. It seemed a little bit to me. I would have liked just a little bit more of focus on the music, but that doesn't mean it wasn't good. Obviously, it was very well received. Where will it go in the pantheon of Super Bowl halftime shows? I think every year they always say, "Oh yeah, that was the greatest show ever." Then you know, after it ages a little bit, it moves down the list. You know, after Madonna went. You know, 10 years ago, they said that was the greatest thing ever. Then they realized what a train wreck it was a week later. That's the thing. But this was fine. It was fine for what it was. Not my taste, but the crowd liked it. The views liked it. And hey, whatever's going to bring in the people, bring it in.
Well, let's go to the younger generation. Yeah. Monique Verdugo, what did you think of the Super Bowl halftime show?
Well, Gru, I understand that you like people just standing there and singing. But this is a Super Bowl.
Out of touch.
Okay, hey, I've been to Super Bowls. I
understand that Michael Jackson stood there for like 5 minutes doing nothing. That was iconic.
That's not what I mean. That's not what I mean.
Please give our special guest. Allow her to please pontificate. What did you think?
Listen, I grew up with that music. My dad was a DJ, so we listened to a lot of, I listened to a lot of old music. That's why I know so much about the, you know, older, you know, I guess you can say your time music.
Oh my God. That's so old.
I know. I'm sorry, Evan. But I absolutely loved it. Would I say it was the greatest halftime show ever? No. Because of the fact, I mean, one, it was great. Don't get me wrong. I sang along in every single song. Kendrick Lamar killed it. Eminem, of course. I wish Eminem had one more song to do that, you know, was from the Slim Shady era. I, you know, seeing 50 Cent was awesome. Loved that. Because that was my song in my generation.
He's like,
you know,
he's like about $1.75 at this point, though.
Right.
Low-hanging fruit. How dare you.
But, no, I mean, it wasn't the greatest of all time. No. But it was a great halftime show, yeah. You know? But, yeah, I would say probably my favorite one to watch was actually Prince. Because, I mean, hello. It was raining. And he was, you know, in purple rain. Come on. Like, that was incredible. Yeah. So, yeah. Also, you had
But aren't these the artists that you and I grew up with, Evan? Shouldn't we be liking more than we do?
Thanks, Andrew. I'll take it from here. we were in our 20s, early 20s, when Snoop and Dre came out with The Chronic. I mean, Dr. Dre had been part of NWA and been around for a while. So, you know, is it overproduced? That's a matter of opinion. I'll probably agree with it, but that's how it's an event now. It's no longer, you know, Springsteen or Prince standing with their band and a solitary guitar and playing. It's become spectacle. And I think the halftime show delivered on everything that it promised. To 50 Cent being $1.75, well, that probably is his cholesterol now.
50
gained a couple of pounds.
Yeah. Y'all want to sit here and talk about 50 Cent looking the way he did. Y'all don't look the same when he came out with that song. So y'all changed too.
Actually, not me. I've looked like this forever. I have looked like this forever, so I can laugh because I've been exactly the same.
I've definitely changed, and I'm going on peptides as soon as we get off this.
My cholesterol's been higher than my SAT score since I was 18.
Well, look, I will say for pure spectacle.
Rest in peace, Gary Shandling.
For pure spectacle and entertainment, I thought the Super Bowl halftime show delivered. And I think that's where they're going to move to. You know, again, grew at WrestleMania. Every year it's the biggest. This year it's the most stupendous. So every year, organizations are going to tout. They're going to tout, you know, what's the greatest. So, all right, guys, moving on. Chevy Chase has no regrets. The 78-year-old comedian finally addressed claims that he was very difficult to work on the set of Saturday Night Live and the TV series Community. In an interview with CBS Sunday this morning, Chase explained how it didn't bother him when he heard that his former co-stars had a bad experience working with him. I guess you'd have to ask them. I don't give a crap, he laughed. I am who I am, and I like where and who I am. The Caddyshack actor played rich, bigoted dude Pierce Hawthorne on the NBC hit sitcom Community for 4 seasons. He left after 2012 after he got into a serious confrontation with creator Dan Harmon. However, Chase made a cameo appearance in the first episode of season 5. Chase reportedly got heated with the showrunner, reportedly using the N-word while objecting to his character's direction. He didn't use the expletive to talk about black cast members Donald Glover or Yvette Nicole Brown. However, the feud angered the cast. Donald Glover, very talented dude, 38, opened up about the fight in 2018 and expressed his feelings about the situation. I just saw Chevy as fighting time. A true artist has to be okay with his reign being over. I can't help him if he's thrashing in the water, but I know there's a human in there somewhere, he told the New Yorker at the time. Harmon was also interviewed for The Profile and claimed that Chase would often interrupt scenes and make racist cracks between scenes. The Rick and Morty co-creator explained how This Is America singer Glover wouldn't let Chase's words affect him. Chevy was the first to realize how immensely gifted Donald was, and the way he expressed his jealousy was to try to throw Donald off. Harmon said, I remember apologizing to Donald after a particularly rough night of Chevy's non-PC verbiage And Donald said, don't even worry about it. Chevy Chase also responded to the interview and said that he was saddened to hear that Donald perceived me in that light. Chase also had notable feuds with his Saturday Night Live castmates, including star Bill Murray. In 1978, the two got into a physical altercation on the set of the NBC sketch series, which he told CBS News he left after season two because he, quote, hated it. Tough one to figure out, guys. What do you think about Chevy Chase and his comments?
Well, they're not comments that he hasn't made before. He's a jerk. He's known to be. None of this is surprising. He's always had trouble. That Saturday Night Live fight with Bill Murray is the stuff of legend. And you know what? I'm a big Chevy Chase fan as far as his work goes.
How dare you? How dare you?
What do you mean?
I'm going to cancel you. How dare you? No, I'm joking. What?
No, I mean, look, Vacation, Fletch, you know, the whole Vacation series, like Spies Like Us, Three Amigos. I mean, he was a very, very funny, endearing performer, but he has always been known as a pain in the ass, egotistical jerk, and now evidently racist as well. And if he's comfortable with that and where he is in life, I don't see him on like Bill Murray and every other in all these movies and popular and whatever. He seems to be just doing like appearances at Christmas Vacation screenings. If he's okay with that, good for him. I don't want him to be unhappy with his life, but don't run away from what you are, and that's kind of what he seems to be trying to do. He is who he is. It doesn't make me any less of a fan, but I'm not going to say that he's not an asshole because I believe he is.
Mony, any thoughts on you? Familiar with Chevy Chase?
He's going to be like, who's Chevy Chase?
The show community.
That's funny, Gert. Yes, I do know who this person is. Yeah, I mean,
it was a compliment. It means you're too young. It was a means you're only 21.
Mony?
Oh, that's sweet. At nine. But, problematic, definitely. Is he going to change? No. Unfortunately, that's just going to be his downfall in his life. He's not going to keep anyone around. He's not going to have any friends. They're all going to realize, dude, you're a jerk and asshole and no one wants to be around you and work with you. Mm. He's going to lose a lot of jobs if he keeps acting like this.
Oh, but he already has.
He said he's not going to change. That's what I'm saying. Like, he's going to keep losing jobs. Yeah. So, you know, with a person like that, you know, just brush it off and be like, probably not ever going to see this guy again. Like, you know.
Do you remember the roast, Evan?
The roast of...
You remember the Comedy Central roast of Chevy Chase?
No.
Oh, it was a train wreck. They couldn't get anybody to show up because everybody hated him. So he had these strangers. He had these strangers ripping him to shreds. Like, it was an embarrassment. And well, that was 20 years ago already.
I think your point, if he's okay with it, I mean, he's got to live with who he is.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm saying. He has to live with who he is, and he has to live with the fact that no one's going to want to be his friend or work with him. You know, and that he's already seeing that.
Yeah,
I think he's of the generation that perhaps racist cracks in the guise of joking was perhaps okay, and he perhaps doesn't realize that in 2000 whatever that's not acceptable anymore. But I agree with Gru. If he's okay with it, then
God bless.
Then we move on. Let me hit up Andrew real quick on a professional wrestling related item here. Number three, Gru. Shocking news in the world of pro wrestling as it was first. Shane McMahon reportedly forced out of the WWE. Last Tuesday, we learned that Cody Rhodes, son of WWE Hall of Famer Dusty Rhodes, and his wife Brandi are leaving Tony Khan and All Elite Wrestling. There's no doubt that Cody Rhodes helped out AEW significantly. He was EVP of the company. And you know what? Oh my God, my copy is so light on here. But nonetheless, Andrew, Cody Rhodes and Brandi Rhodes have left All Elite Wrestling. And, of course, the big rumor is he's on his way to the WWE. Any thoughts on Cody Rhodes returning to the WWE?
Yeah, I would love to see it because I really don't think he was well utilized when he was in the WWE before. Hence, I guess, why he left. And this is we talk about moving the needle a little bit. this will move the needle. I mean, if we know that Cody Rhodes is showing up on SmackDown or Raw, we're going to be watching it, and we're going to watch it as soon as we can. That's a big deal. Now, what they do with it, that's a whole other story. Okay, but as far as the lore of it, I'm hooked already, because just like we learned with WCW versus WWE, anything that involves the two it generates interest. And this is the guy who pretty much started AEW, right?
Yeah, hold on. I'm getting a message from my producer. Producer Mony, we got three more items.
Okay.
All right, we got to speed for time. Here's what I will say. I agree with Andrew, though. In the world of pro wrestling, Cody Rhodes moves the needle.
Yeah.
If you're the WWE, you offer him a big contract, you get him in, WrestleMania. That's going to help promote the show.
And you don't do Stardust, guys, right? You don't do Stardust, right?
No, you don't do Stardust. Okay, agreed. Pete Davidson has rejoined Instagram for the fourth time since ditching the social media platform in 2018. A new profile featuring Instagram's verification checkmark went live this Wednesday, just days after Kanye West took the platform to bombard the stand-up with insults in an effort to win back his ex and Davidson's current girlfriend, Kim Kardashian. Look at this dickhead, West 44 captioned a paparazzi photo of Davidson and Kardashian before making fun of his recent Calvin Klein ad co-starring Machine Gun Kelly. Let's cut it for time. What do you guys think about this whole Kanye West, Pete Davidson feud on Instagram over Kim Kardashian? There, go.
It's harassment at this point. It's stalkerish. It's creepy. Kanye, move on. Your ex-wife has obviously moved on. It's done. Just stop. Like, you are literally going to put yourself in asylum. Like, acting like this. Just cut. He's already had major problems. This is nothing new of how he's acting, but it's becoming kind of like harassment and stalky. So,
I think it's all.
From one stalker to another. What do you think of?
It's all part. I think it's all part of the master plan for Kanye West to pass the torch to Pete Davidson as the number one psychotic, crazy nut job out there, because Pete was already a wackadoo. So this to me is funny, but not worth my time at the same time. I will say this, though.
I hate seeing this. Annoying.
It's one thing that has happened is that Pete Davidson has become funnier on Saturday Night Live. I have to say that. So I don't know if it's connected. I don't know if it's connected, but,
They're definitely using him more into more well-rounded. His first couple of years, it was sort of that slacker. He was always sort of that slackerish, kind of what he plays in stand-up, that slackerish kind of character. Now they're using him for some impressions, and they're using him maybe capitalizing on his increased popularity.
But he's doing it very well, and I never really found him funny. I find myself laughing at his stuff at morning.
I will do a quick promo for William Dafoe hosted a couple of weeks ago, and they did a takeoff on Nugenics, the testosterone.
Yes, I saw that. Yeah.
That was very, very funny. Yeah. Very, very funny. All right, guys, let's finish it up. Last Thursday, a photographer. Let me just do this real quick here.
You're on finally, the hard 180. Last
Thursday for the Rams is on the mend after she took a brutal fall at the team's 2022 Super Bowl parade and fractured her spine.
Oh, boy.
Right in front of Matthew Stafford, who immediately walked away from the scene. Kelly Smiley, who is a photographer for the Crypto.com Arena, the LA Kings and the Anaheim Ducks, was captured on video falling right in front of Rams star quarterback and his wife Kelly in the clip. In the clip, Stafford sees Smiley fall backwards off the team's Rams house stage and quickly turns and walks away, appearing to say, "Oh my God," as he does. Meanwhile, his wife appears stunned and walks towards Smiley. Please check your monitors. Here's Matthew Stafford and his wife. And his, I don't even know what his wife's name, but
probably watching, one name like Zendaya or something.
Watching a photographer fall off the stage.
I don't hear anything. Did you click the sound? Or is there sound on this?
I don't know, but you could see how she fell off, right?
We could see. There she go. Whoa. Everybody is like, He's probably going to call 911.
Some people online were critical of Stafford's reaction. How do you watch a person fall like that and just walk away? Tweeted WBC News anchor Liam Martin. Oh, I apologize.
Really? Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Say that again, please.
A local news anchor tweeted, how do you watch a person fall off the stage like that and just walk away? People are criticizing Matthew Stafford's
right.
reaction.
No, 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 no. But, okay.
His wife appears concerned. Yeah. Matthew Stafford apparently is drunk, and he says, oh, my God, and walks away. So I just thought it was a funny clip.
It is a funny clip. It is a funny clip. But you know, you always react to hypocrisy. So here's this news anchor jumping all over that. Let me ask a news anchor a question. Okay, when a news anchor goes down to like Hurricane Katrina and interviews a couple homeless people who just lost everything they ever had, do they take them with them and put them up in a hotel and buy them all? Or do you say, thank you, here's a cracker, now go to your empty hole? Like, shut the fuck up. Who are these people to, like, everybody does their own thing. I'm no Matthew Stafford fan, but he's not a doctor. Like, what are we supposed to do? Are we, like, I don't know. It's just people are just so quick to judge a 19-second little clip right there of a guy literally, all I saw was a guy turning around, you know, and looking in another direction for a split second because, I don't know. It's just, it's just, that's what bothers me about it. Not, it's when people just jump to this and say, oh, you know, screw him. Like, what?
Okay.
What
so
would you
I
do?
I don't know. I don't know if your comparison is apt, you know, having a news anchor who's interviewing people post a hurricane. But and again, I'll agree with you about the social media piece. But I mean, come on, dude, somebody falls off the stage. You should be kind of human and maybe fake it. But
not if you're drunk.
Walks. Okay. Well, I mean, I would hope if I saw somebody fall off a stage, I would walk over and try to see and try to help them.
Yes, obviously, but it's not a felony if you, I mean.
Nobody said he's a felony. He just received criticism online. Mony, any final thoughts? Boy, this has come crashing.
This is
halt.
So weird because do we have like the full like video of what happened after? Do we have anything that happened after the fact? I mean, I'm sorry, but I'm not going to lie. Okay. Would I react the same way? Sure. I'll be like, oh my God, and turn around, not knowing what just happened, you know, because it's like, did she just fall and just to fall, or did she hurt herself? He probably didn't know.
She fractured her spine.
No, no. I mean, like, he didn't know that she was, you know, hurt. You know what I mean? You know, so I think it's just kind of like it's so tricky to comment on that. Because, his wife was like, oh, my God. You could see his wife being like, oh, my God. Like, you know, trying to, like, possibly, you know. But she had probably everyone around her, you know, probably trying to check to see if she was okay and all that stuff. So we don't know the full story of what happened after the fact.
Well, here's what we'll do. We'll get some cameras. I'll get drunk. And then, Mony, I want you to fall off a...
You want me to
stage.
Fracture my spine?
Well,
no,
I do not.
Well, the real question is
spine.
The real question is to put a cap on the thing. The real question is the woman who fell okay?
So here's a little bit of an interesting backstory. She fractured her spine. She did a GoFundMe page, and then guess what happened with her? She got outed apparently for a couple of years earlier, tweeting some racial stuff. So now the social media is down on the photographer who fell. So she had a GoFundMe, and I think her GoFundMe was closed down because I don't know when, back in 2000 or whatever, she tweeted something weird of some kind of racial note.
You know,
so everybody's a little
ridiculous. You know what? Wow. Fuck this. I'm moving to Ukraine. All right? That's it. Oh, whoa, too soon? Too soon.
Well, thank you. I want to thank Mony, and I want to thank Andrew,
yes.
Andrew for our next Nothing Worthwhile podcast. It's Gru and I will be something to do with Howard Stern. We're going to call it Howard Stern, The Other Side, or Howard Stern, The Refugees. We're going to take a look at the Howard Stern Show, all the major players who have come and gone over the years, their impact to the show, their impact on the show once they've left. Andrew Gruthius, we're on a hard 180. But give us real your thoughts, Howard Stern, The Other Side.
Very excited about that one. In fact, I'm thinking it might need to be a two-weeker because there's definitely a lot to talk about. We're going to be talking about Howard Stern, The Other Side, The Refugees next week. And maybe even the week after. And then I believe, Evan, we're going to be right. We're going to be right on the road to WrestleMania at that point. You know, I mean, we got to start. You know, getting on with all the storylines and everything that's going on with that stuff.
Tomorrow will be 1 week, 1 month.
Yes,
we got 4 weeks.
Yes, so ladies and gentlemen, please join us next week for Howard Stern, The Refugees, and then we are officially on the road to WrestleMania. Mony, thank you so much for being here with us today. It was so much fun.
Thank you.
Please join us every week, okay? the pay is not that good, but there are fringe benefits we can talk about later. But everybody is so excited here at Nothing Worthwhile. Don't forget, we've got Van Dammit coming up after WrestleMania. What's it going to be? We're going to take a little sabbatical from JCVD and going to go to SS, Steven Seagal, talking about On Deadly Ground. But ladies and gentlemen, my thanks to Evan Moody, to Mony, our incredible guest today. Thanks again, and we'll see you next time. Until then, ladies and gentlemen, 1, 2, 3.
Rip 'em!
Quack, quack.